brother, where your armor the Moshe, soul Marcus Gavi. Brother, where your armor the Moshe, soul Marcus Gavi.
Hey, welcome to Southern California KPFK, Brother Steve Coakley.
Hey, good evening, brother.
One of our great researchers that have exposed the boule, a phenomenon that most of us in the movement never knew about until you came and brought light, took the sheets off of these Negro Klan members and explained to us what the boule is all about. Let me ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Howard University, for instance, in a number of African so-called Greek societies, fraternities,
mm-hmm.
as well as in our communities, a number of secret, semi-secret organizations. How is the boule different than the numerous fraternities and groups in our community? What is the relationship to the ruling class?
Father, son. Mm-hmm. Nine make up the axis of the Black Greek dynasty. There are four male societies, four female societies, and the boule make the ninth one. They're the first, 1904 series, the alphas. I'm not versed in the exact order, but I have all of their history books, and each of them draw attention to things where they got their ritual from. The deltas draw attention to Freemasonry, said our ritual came from Mary Church Terrell, whose husband Robert Terrell was head of the Masonic Lodge in Washington, D.C. Mary Church Terrell, Mary Church, is the daughter of the first Black millionaire in America, Robert Church of Memphis, Tennessee. Huge mausoleum to him there. Those societies, those four male, those four female, and the boule tend to make up a aristocracy. We talked in the park about the 10%, not in the sense of us in exclusivity, but them in the terms of deputizing 10% of the population to assure that the 90% never catch on. And it's very important to know that if you look to Alpha Phi Alpha website, there's alphas, kappas, q's, and Phi Beta Sigma. There's Zeta Phi Beta, Delta Sigma Theta, aka, and Deltas, I'm missing somebody, Sigma Gamma Rho. If you look to, say, the Alpha website, they brag about being 95% of all Black lawyers. Mm-hmm. Now, if the Alphas are 95% of the Black lawyers, what does that leave the Kappas, the Qs? Okay, now we're in the 90s. They claim to be 65% of the Black accountants, the lawyers, the doctors, dominating. And it may be that our professions are dominated by people in the Greek societies. At Howard, there was a student that I tried to help get a doctorate in engineering. Very exclusive about giving them out. If you get one, you're set for life. Morgan State, Howard are very exclusive. Took big money from governments to make engineers, but the brothers weren't coming out. And when we got deeply involved, we found how close-knit, how selective the professional process is. So he ended up at the patent office. He was a Kappa. He said, we have 15 Blacks, one female, 14 brothers, and all 14 of us are Kappas. Only Kappas gonna get in here. And there are jobs all over where we think we're applying for something fair and open. But I would suggest that the ruling class recognize this was a very significant period, Dedan, when they decided that they would give a college degree to a person of African ancestry in America who after Reconstruction should have been pretty pissed off. And so they were very weak about it to Africans in America. Only 2,000. So there was this thing they went through, a born man versus the made man. The born man, the king and the queens of Europe, had to deputize people to colonize the lands, the Columbuses and the Cecil Rhodeses who went to Africa. They weren't the aristocracy, but they fought to be gladiators and colonists and explorers, the Lewis and Clark who were Masons. These men used the societies to advance the wishes of the ruling class, and they set up a system, a circle within a circle, within another circle. Each circle protected the circle within it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look to that boule logo, you see there's an urn. There's an animal with the wing of the bird, a tail of a lion, and it's got an urn, and it's got its paw over the urn. And it says in the history book number 2 by Hobart Jarrett that in the urn are the names of the people who are chosen to lead the state, which suggests that part of the society function is not to make known who the people of power and authority are. And one of their most serious indictments to this society is what they were used to do against Marcus Garvey.
Could you explain that, please?
Marcus Garvey, who began to surge for Africa. The Negro was breaking free, doesn't have a good reason to get with the white American establishment.
You're right.
They don't have a good reason.
They're not getting paid.
They built the country, got set free, didn't get the 40 acres and the mule.
Right.
Got reconstructed when they began to move into the southern houses and the Senate. They got reconstructed and knocked back. So there's disarray in our community. And this is before the industrial cities of Chicago and others began to have steel. And the stock markets, not the bonds,
mm-hmm.
Where people began to work in the South, fled to the North to work in those factories. And
mm-hmm.
Robert Abbott,
mm-hmm.
who was a Boulay man from Chicago, Chicago Defender, who it was a period when all the black editors were brought into Washington and told that they were to crack down on Marcus Garvey, and their newspapers were not to be used, the Pittsburgh Courier, Chicago Defender, the Afro-American in Baltimore and Washington. All of these are Boulé families, the advisors to the king, this group. So when Marcus Garvey came, whites began to think that maybe assimilation is better. Maybe we can escalate. Let's not let these go. Maybe they don't seem too pissed off about all of this. Maybe they'll forgive these things we did to their ancestors. And maybe we can trick them, have a little, want some more. So as Garvey began to move, they began to see that a Harlem Renaissance could have been necessary, that they could then attract Africans in America in the literature and science and the arts and poetry. And when he said back to Africa, he trying to get to Liberia. So R.R. Moulton, who was a big Boulé man from Tuskegee University, who replaced Booker T. Washington, R.R. Moulton became a spy for the U.S. government to coordinate the program against Marcus Garvey in America. We have declassified documents that came out in 1993. The Memphis Commercial Appeal did the story about Martin King, Kwame Ture. A lot of things came out about spying. Well, in that, which did not make the public press when we actually filed for the documents, there was R.R. Moulton telling Von DeMond at Military Intelligence, don't tell anyone what I'm going to tell you about what Marcus Garvey said last night in Harlem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the letters marked confidential. And of course, eventually, R.R. Moulton, who went to Liberia, was given $5 million to form a committee to keep Marcus Garvey out of Liberia. He never made it. He wanted to get there bad. They put $5 million in 1919, man, this is $50 million, $100 million today. Inconceivable. And they rewarded R.R. Moulton for trying to undermine Marcus Garvey. He got the first, Dick, this is deep, he got the first black veterans hospital in the United States,
mm-hmm.
at Tuskegee.
Mm-hmm.
And then what did they give him for reward? Syphilis. You see the reward?
Yeah,
he got something.
No back.
But what they got was bad, what they gave him, you know.
So let me ask you, so in essence what you're saying is that the Boulé represents the buffer class, the petit bourgeois, the comprador buffer class that manages Africa's workers, peasants, students, and middle class in many ways,
mm-hmm.
and are paid well for that. And they received their direct orders from a European capitalist class.
Yes, if you were to look to today, where Boulé members like Vernon Jordan, who is managing director of Goldman Sachs, he took Bill Clinton to his first Bilderberger meeting in 1971. The black man took the white man from Arkansas to the big international meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Vernon Jordan, former head of the Urban League, who groomed Ron Brown, who then went on to become Secretary of Commerce, killed in a plane crash, murdered,
mm-hmm.
Because Boulé are considered domestic. Martin King was Boulé. Look at the relationship between Martin and Kwame over going against the war. You don't hear anybody in the African center community primarily against the war.
Mm-hmm.
They're basically accepting it or looking for what they try to get when whites are passing out things like, you know, a grant here, this or that. They don't appear to be focused on that money that's being wasted, those billions of dollars.
You say African community
Africans
support the war?
They are not. No. I'm just saying they are not pushing against the war.
Yeah.
Same way Martin King.
I just say what
you're saying. April 4th of 67, one year before he was killed to the day, when he came out of Riverside Church with Kwame and a shirt and tie in the front row,
mm-hmm.
waiting to hear, because he called and said, you got to mm-hmm. hear this. He comes out against the war. Boulé men are told to be domestic, not international.
Mm-hmm.
Mickey Leland was Sigma Pi Phi.
Mm-hmm.
He tried to stop a starvation going on in Ethiopia, Somalia. his plane crashes into the mountain, congressman from Texas. He dies. Ron Brown, Martin King. Yeah, no question. Martin King became international, and that became his biggest sin. He was financed by some of the greatest foundations America ever had to offer. But if they get beyond the defined limit, then there's trouble.
Toss the Dutch on the left hand side.
Toss
the Dutch on the left hand side.
We are the state of Ireland. Get out here. Continent.
Yes, Muta. Big up to Jerry Smart.
You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Since he's been gone, you've been crying. You took him for more than a friend, but he lied and cheated instead. I'm here to dry up your tears, to dry up your tears, dry up your tears. Oh yeah. Lying. Ever since he's been gone, you've been crying. You took him for more than a friend, but he lied and cheated instead. I'm here to dry up your tears, to dry up your tears, dry up your tears, oh yeah, right. Draw up your tears, oh yeah. Draw your tears, oh. I'm gonna dry your tears, oh yeah. I'm gonna dry your tears.
You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Keep way bad boy. I bully, bully, bully down bad boy. Who laugh, who laugh?
You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Yeah, man.
Keep way bad boy. I bully, bully, bully down bad boy. Who laugh, who laugh, who laugh? Bad boy, will you see? Roughneck there, ragamuffin everywhere. Place run red, the times a dread. Be careful, mind you lose your head. Some a clown, jump around. Say hey, he my bad boy at town. Run it hot, licking shot. He my going up in a dove cart. Every day him run me saving me the magnum. Booba 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 police a come. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Bad boy will you speak? Cool off, cool off, cool off. Before you lose the race. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Bad boy have some sense. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Too much violence. Now it's time to understand. Come away you from the sinking sand. The things you do, you won't get through. The cops are always coming at you. Change your plan, be a better man. Before them care, you go by station. Some ideas are years of bliss. It's time to change your dirty ways. Every day you run, you say you lead your magnum. Booba 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 police a call. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Bad boy have some sense. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Too much violence. Cool off, cool off, cool off.
And the cutting edge in Mota Baroka.
Cool off, cool off, cool off. Before you lose the race. Get jumpy and then get swayed. Boy, time to stop before you drop. Soon you'll feel the aftercloths. So much died along the way. Don't you throw your life away. Please take heed, slow down your speed. In your heart there's so much greed. Chicken Mary happening. Bad boy, you better be real. Every day you run, you say you lead the mark, no. Booba, 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 police a come. Cool off, cool off, cool off. Why would you see this? Cool off, cool off, cool off. Before you lose the race. Cool off, cool off, cool off.
On the cutting edge in Mota Baroka. What the term is set. Hey, them can't stop me now. As long as jam music rock. Tika 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 tak. Hey Mota, get him an extra.
Yes, we are blood.
Yes, we are blood.
We are blood, the whole of we are one blood. Together we must get far. We are blood, the whole of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war. We are blood, the whole of we are one blood. Together we must get far. We are blood, the whole of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war. Been so long you've been holding us back. Never gonna get us off the right track. We've been up, we've been down, we've been pushed all around. Someday we gonna stand on a firm ground. Look in the mirror, tell me what do you see? The image of another man just like me. If our one should get hurt, we all feel the pain. Same blood is running through our veins. We are blood, the whole of we are one blood. Together we will get far. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we will get far. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war. Politicians, they come, they teach us a feast. But the war can't cease. In the ghetto they cry, don't ask me why. Oh Lord, I try. My blood is red, I think yours is the same. Don't let your brother drink from the drain. Day to day we all feel the strain. Why must there be sorrow and pain? We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we will get far. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we will get far. We are blood, all of we are one blood. Together we must stop the war.
RFM, number one reggae station in the whole wide world. And I drew a
thank you.
good night. This is the Cutting Edge on IRFM with you. And next Wednesday night, you're listening to the man called Harris Andy. We give you two spin-off. Junior Delgado, the late Junior Delgado, man. May I tell you? Harris Andy. You know, say Champs step away again, yeah? Yes, and Easter. Big things are going, you know. And Trump. I tell you, man. I can't get enough of this man, yeah, you know. This man, yeah, I'm a way, man. I tell you, man. Trump, everybody yesterday. $40 million in a Florida, them spend for discredit him. And them still beat the whole of Florida. Big riot going in Chicago. If you say thousands of people are demonstrating against him, I guess what? He's still winning at Chicago. It's amazing, man. Believe you me, it's amazing. It's a phenomenon. Never in the history of American election, anything like this ever happened. But it's all what America is. And Trump is the epitome of what America is. And then sweep it under the carpet continuously. Here's a man who come on this side and say, he must just be himself and just tell it like how it is. Him is part of the system that is grinding slowly. Him is part of the system. Even though himself is not a part of the system. But all of them is part of the system. The system operate outside of them and manipulate and control them, and them don't even recognize it. It's what you call mind control. Big mind control are going. But him is one of them where he's saying what them have in their mind that them would have liked said, but true, them is so conservative and diplomatic. Them can't say where him has said. Where him has said is where most white people in America have in them intention, and most of the conservative people them is where them have in them intention, but them not say it. The only reason why I'm so terrible and blatant is because them scared. Him go let out the puss out of the bag. Trump let out the puss out of the bag and show them say, him not say it that way there, but when really I say, look here, man, don't stop pretending and go on like an idiot, man. We want to build a wall and get rid of them little Mexican where I come across the border, come rape people. And them damn Muslim people there were not Christian. But the latest endorsement I hear is Charles Manson. No, when I hear them thing, I feel like, how many people are listening to me know who named Charles Manson? I want you to go Google Charles Manson. Tracy, you know who named Charles Manson? But Tracy not in there. But Tracy there. Me thinks that she's in behind me, you know. Oh, you look like a girl, so Bridget. Yeah, no, Google Charles Manson. Google Charles Manson and see who Charles Manson is. And Charles Manson turned Christian out to, you know. Yes, Charles Manson turned Christian. Charles Manson endorsed Trump. The Ku Klux Klan endorsed Trump. All the degenerates of America endorsed Trump. Believe you me. Plus, well-educated white people endorse Trump. Well-educated. Plus, the Christian them endorse Trump. Can you believe that? Yes. The Christian them is who vote for them. You know, see the man, you know, see Ben Carson. Anybody never see Ben Carson come out here one time? Ben Carson did write a book that was very popular, you know, but Ben Carson endorsed Trump. Ben Carson is one of the most quiet Christian upon the whole of the conservative people them. And him endorsed Trump. The Christian them is voting for Trump. What that tell you? What is that telling you when a man like Trump have the Christian them a come out in them droves a vote for him? Him is saying exactly what them have in them intention. Keep America white. Simple. Keep America white. Blood and skirt boat them a go in lake one black man there. where them are though? Are mad them mad? Or them put black man there so? In a White House. Keep America white. Cause them try the black man thing, you know. Them try the black man thing. Yeah. Them try the black man thing. Them say, boy, when America was in that problem internationally, it's the only face could have started out certain things with the, with the, with the people them who they start on a like way. Them did have to use that black face for lift up back America. And the black face lift up back America now. A time for him done, you know, go back to normal, business as usual. We have to put back America how it's supposed to be. These damn conservative people, them know where them have not them intention. But this brother, you know, because I'm not a politician and him is really a rich butto. Him don't know how to behave like a politician. So him just say the things them. And the people them love it. The people them love it. And they sop it up. Believe you me. All the, me say, them have a little clip of them show up on the TV where a man, a black brother, thump a white boy in his face. And the next old man. The way they think, you know, the old man, when the black brother walk up the stairs, the old man elbow him. And when them ask the old man about it, you hear the old man say, the next time I'm going to kill him. And guess what? Trump say I'm going to pay for the man lawsuit. I'm going to pay them. I'm going to pay the man court fee. The man who elbowed the black youth, you know. Him say I'm going to pay for the man court fee. It's not a funny thing I go on in America, you know. It's funny, but it's not funny, you know. Because you hear the last thing Trump said, you know. Trump said, look here, man. I don't be the only one talk about convention and meeting, and then you have a little select few come elect now who going to run against the Democratic Party. The man or the person with the highest amount of vote should be the candidate to run against the Democratic Party. I agree with him. You can't come sit down now and the man who have the most vote, you come say, boy, right now, I'm not suitable. So you go draft your man who no have no vote. Or take a man who never run at all and put him there. So Trump say, watch your man, it's right to know I start in America. And believe you me, you know, it's that way. Anyhow. And I start understand. I say not even when Obama did it, I'm so interested in American politics, you know. And it's like me interested in American politics now, because I can't tell you exactly what is what and what is that, and all the phrases and all the this and that and the Super Tuesdays. And me learned so much from watching it because of Trump. But what me I say now is that, you see, if them are care that thing, they go to a convention and go talk about, say, Trump is not suitable, even though them have most of the vote them, and go elect all that guy around the corner, you know. Believe it's not inside him, inside riot, you know. Him not inside riot, you know, but it's, you know, but him said plain. Everybody said, you know, it would be a character convention, it would be a mistake, it would be it just come out and say, watch out, convention meeting, say the man who, because if him not win, a riot, I'm saying my inside riot, exactly what go happen, and that go happen in America. You think, say the North Korean president wouldn't like the Trump win. Yeah, I tell you, that Korean man will have for the youth. I give 15 years to take a sign where advance the North Korean government. It look like him in a hotel room and draw down the sign. And it's either the maid come in and not see the sign and realize, you know what them say? I send him a CIA, FBI and some little right-wing Christian people. Make him take long the sign, so they're going give him 15 years, and them give him 15 years. I tell you. The Christian, them love Trump. When Trump say, him, they must stop all Muslims from coming in America until them can sort out why, what is it and what is not. And when the man look at Trump and say, but Trump, you're against extremist Muslims are... It's just Muslim you're against. Trump said, look here, man. You see, the man and the woman, where they live in America, were going at a little party there and kill the people them. Only they know see them people that do that. Or you separate the extremist Muslim them from the normal Muslim. You can't separate them. Trump say you can't separate them. So stop them from coming there until they sort it out. The Christian them love that. See a Christian up on the TV and I say the Jews them should convert to Christianity too. If it does Trump 100%. When the woman asks him, so tell me something. Are you actually saying that Jew, that you know, so that's a disrespect to the Jews? He said, I don't care. There's no other name. This is American black man now. Said, there's no other name that anybody can be saved but Jesus Christ. So the Jews should convert too. So that is the level of thinking we are going in America now, you know, because the Christian them, are following because him talk against the Muslim them. Believe you me. White people love when them say lick down the border, draw big wall around the border, and the other two people them, they don't agree with it too, you know. The other two people them, the one named Cruz and Rubio, he might agree with it, you know, but how Trump say it? Because sometimes it's not what you say, you know, it's how you say it. When you say how him say it, it's just a normal way for talk it. Normal way. You know, it's not like you are pretty top. I'm going to build a wall, high wall. Anybody who they are illegal, I'm going to take them out of my country. I don't care how much it's 10 million, 8 million, them going to have to leave and who they are, have to get themselves legitimate. That is what Trump are dealing with. Trump is the ultimate white supremacist. May I tell you? And that's supposed to wake up black people in America. That's supposed to make the black power movement and all the movement them will die out because them get complacent and get passive because them feel say America now is we the people. You think say when them guys that did that right, we the people are black people them that I talk about. Black them never had no black people right. Because black people was one-fifth of a human being in America up to the other day. As a matter of fact, you could have still writing at them constitution too. Black people was one-fifth of a human being in America up to the 60s. Them have tile it where mark blacks, white. Black tile it, white tile it. Up to the 60s. When me born, I said I got school. Them have tile it in America. Public tile it was say black people for going out of tile it there, white people for going out of tile it there. Lynching, racism rise. Since 8 years of Obama, there have been more racist attacks in America than ever before. So when them are going and are going like say, oh my God, where is this guy coming from? What is this guy, what is he saying? Oh, blah, 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 blah. Him saying exactly what white people have in their mind. And black people for know that. Black people for know say you see when if you study, well I tell nobody if you go study it though. Look on history, man. History must teach you. I was going to repeat it. History shows that empires come and empire go. And there is certain things that take place when an empire is going down, you know. And I say it already and I go and say it again, you know. Who would have thought or who would remember that Greece, the same Greece right now where was in problems with the International Monetary Fund. Who would have thought that Greece would be like a third world country now in the world? Greece, that was a superpower in America, in the world. Superpower. Greece, the Greco-Roman dynasty, the superpower of Greece, went straight into Egypt, Iran, Iraq, all of these places. Who would have known that Greece right now would have reached a stage where Greece there? You have to take sleep and mark that. And know, say, empires come and empire go. And no matter how you see them mighty, them say, how are the mighty fallen? And the mighty just don't know when them fall or when they are falling, you know. And the people them must look and see that there's certain signs that is taking place right now in the world. That sure you say America is on the decline when it come on to power. America is on the decline. You have to look on it. You have to see it. You have to understand it. So when you hear people are big up America, they say not big up America, they say not big up America, they big up America, this of course big up America. America have the biggest weapon them and mass destruction, this tribe. America is the only country that will ever drop an atomic bomb on the next country. Can you believe that? America have more, America population is 300 odd million people. China population, feeble times, America population. America have more prisoners in prison than any other country in the world, including China. Check that. America have more prisoners in prison than any other country in the world. How is that possible? This is a country where breed, sleep, eating democracy. Them sleep it, them eat it, them breathe it, and them behave like say them is the most democratic country. According to the last survey that I read, America is the world's first world country to live in. It's not me I tell that, you know. These are the people them who tell you about this and tell you about that. Them say America is the world's first world country to live in. America control the world. Them have control in a places where don't even know say they are controlled. When we look on the cultural expression of America that has that gone right over the world. We talk about the eating, drinking, sexual whatsoever, sexual manipulation, eating manipulation, music manipulation. I mean, you name it, the manipulation. This is what you call imperialism, you know. When you hear people talk about imperialism, we have a new imperialism that takes place with them. Them don't call it imperialism again, you know. Them call it globalization. Globalization, them call it. Globalization is American imperialism. We can't say that again. Globalization is American imperialism. It's a system by which America used that to manipulate economic power, cultural power, social power. You name all the power them where it's designed for human being to exist as human beings. Think of all that, social, political, religious. Name all of them and you realize America is the power behind all of these things. The way you eat, the what you wear, how you think about life, your sexual pleasures and desires, and how you want to have sex and who you want to have sex with is manipulated. So you do things right now where you think is you actually do it. And it's very difficult to get out of it, you know. You have to have a different logics and move you to really get out of it. You have to take a effort, a serious effort to say, look, you know, you see me now, me nah do that, you know, no matter what. Me nah think that way, you know, no matter what. Me nah eat that, you know, no matter what. Me nah wear that, you know, no matter what. Me nah gear it out, you know, no matter what. It's very difficult for you to do it because, you see, the more this imperialistic thing come upon you, it's the more it look like a normal situation you find yourself in. where I try to explain to the people them how a system control your movements. Cause some people, in all them ignorance, them feel comfortable, you know. So sometimes people say, well, you don't know what hurt you. It's madness that, you know. It's madness when a man says, well, you don't know what hurt you, you know. Because sometimes what you don't know is it hurt you more. But you know what I'm now? Because how them arrive at the manipulation of beings and things is use the ignorance of the people. And them design it that way too. Them design to keep us in ignorance. Continuously, perpetually. We need to escape, you know. But the only thing, the only way we can escape is we have an alternative to them thing. You know, see it? And we have an alternative, as a matter of fact, we have our own thing. But it's going to take us a very long time to realize that our thing serve we. For thousands of years, our thing did not serve we, you know. But the continuous manipulation of world events, time, you see time, it's when a man can manipulate time and a man can manipulate your brains by making you see things that don't really real and make you buy into the illusion that him sell you and you don't know it's an illusion and make you use his expressions for the dog and come to a conclusion about things where him himself put up there. I mean, when we look at the Greco-Roman influence upon the Western world right now, we could never talk about America, but just look how Greco-Roman influence the Western world. That you can't tell a man who is into that Greco-Roman thinking, that is a Greco-Roman thinking, that is not for him thinking. Because the reversal is that for him thinking, when did I think before Greco-Roman ideas, it's not good for human being. What we are talking about? We are talking about religion. We are talking about religion. Or we did have our way. As African people, we did have our way for see things and understand things. And them use them influence and manipulation and reverse the thing now that we now look on everything that is we is not good. Everything that is we not bad, not good. See, some things where we are innately just we, just our DNA say just we that. We strive not to accept it as ourselves because it looks like something outside of what they tell us it's supposed to be. So the Greeks them come and them give we a doctrine. The Roman them come and them give we a doctrine. And it is almost like a blueprint now to how you as an African can be saved. So when you hear a man now like the man where endorse Trump and I say, there's no other name that man can be saved upon earth but through the name of Jesus Christ. And the Jews, they must now convert to Christianity. How much Jamaican people would I say them do agree with that? Most Jamaican, I can talk about, I'd say like 99.99% of Jamaican people, including the gunman them, would I tell you, say, a Jesus. And them don't know from whence that thinking come. That thinking, that Greece. And the first time the new thing. Watch ya, man. A man tell you about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and all these people. A write. You think say in a them days a fisherman could a write where you see this, huh? A man. You think a man where I catch fish every day or I walk up and down every day, you think say him could have the right where you see right now where you take as the gospel? The first time those things was written in the language of the colonial master, Greek, Greco-Roman language. It's what dominated the so-called Middle East at the time, 2,000 years ago. It was the Greco-Roman language. The Greco-Roman language was what you call the elite language. Not even now, not even some of the Jews them could have read Greco-Roman language, who call themselves big scribes and Pharisees and them thing there. And you are telling me, say, a man will walk up and down every day and a sell fish and grown provision, write them thing they were using in other book there. I don't know how we think that way there. My lady just bring it to my attention today. She say, she's a little, she read that thing and she say, if Jesus Christ was in the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights by himself. This is a serious thing, you know. I mean, look, the whole day, me I think about it. I should know, so me I think about it the whole day. You know. Me I think about it the whole day. She said, she read something and she said, if Jesus Christ was in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights and he was confronting this devil, that tempt him and I tell him if you do. How the hell a man who never did know exactly where they are going? At what point did Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, whosoever did write down the meeting of these two forces, how did they know to transcribe the language, what was said to one and the other one, what was said, well, 40 days and 40 nights, him alone in the wilderness. 40 days and 40 nights, him in alone in the wilderness, and you read something where a man write down and tell you, say, and the devil say, if you the son of God, throw yourself off of this mountain. If you, and him say, get behind me, Satan. And all them know that, to write that. The ignorant, blissful person that say, well, you know, the power of God is so mightyful, you know, that him put the spirit in a macho or Mark or Luke or John. If he knows, says this will take place, so him write it down. Madness. Madness. That is what you call, you need to see a psychiatrist or a psychologist or whosoever them use for kind of put people's brains together. So America come now as the new Greek, Greco-Roman Empire. Because Greece fall and Roman fall. Because Rome fall now, you don't hear about Rome again. The only time you hear about Rome, really, is when you hear about the Pope. And the Pope have his own little country in a Rome. It's weird. The Pope authority in him country. It's a country within a country. The Pope authority within the country gone beyond the Roman, the country itself, the place, the Italy. Rome is in Italy. Vatican City is in Rome. So you have Italy, you have Rome, and you have the Vatican City. The Vatican City is the smallest country, headed and governed not by a president or a prime minister or a king, but by a religious leader who say him is the vicar of Christ, representative of Christ on earth. That is what you call theocracy. It's not democracy. It's not democracy that is theocracy where God rule. But because you don't know God, who God, where God there and empty there, you put a man there and say, see, there's him represent me. Him represent God. Anything where him say is God attack. Just like in Iran, with the Ayatollah them. The Ayatollah them run off a thing named theocracy where nobody don't know who God is. But you see when them talk, them tell you say God represent that. Just like Moses in the Bible, Moses represent the word of God. It's theocracy. Him catch all of him try the Levite, them put them in a place named Tabernacle. And when them come out, they know them talk to this box where them call Ark of the Covenant. And when them talk to the box or whatsoever them doing at the tabernacle, them come out and say, thus saith the Lord God of Israel. Trick the people them. Well, not trick the people them, but want to control the people them. Because that was the purpose of Moses. Moses was to control the people them. Lead them in a direction. Because them never want to stay in Egypt, according to Philem's story. So we look upon the doctrine of imperialism and say, oh, we set us on now. Oh, this thing I set. We can't come out of it if we don't totally transform yourself. You have to transform yourself. You have to transform yourself. Become a new creation. A new person. Because them have your eat things where you're not supposed to eat. And you know, the way they think about it, it's like a man look on a cigarette box and say, the box say, warning, cigarette smoking is dangerous to their health. And them still go buy the cigarette and smoke it. Oh, the hell them look at them, they make you do that. On the box, it marks smoking kill. I mean, really, really now. The man put on the box, smoking kill. And you go buy the cigarette still and ignore the sign. You ignore the sign. That is like you see a sign on the road. Me Angela Brown work. I mean, no, it's funny. The mayor a kid so that talk today about the people them who they're gonna try evict. And she said, Jamaica really reach away, but can't really reach away. You what she said though? She said, you have a sign mark, no vending. And the people them put up the clothes where they must sell upon the sign. No, no, I laugh. It's the funniest thing I hear. Angela said, she can't understand the mindset of Jamaican people. Them see upside back, no vending. And the things them where they must sell, the made in China, them hang up the things them on the side of the mark, no vending. How the hell them get you to do that? If you ignore a sign, how them get you to buy a box of cigarette, we say, smoking kill. Me give thanks to Tracy no smoke, you know. Because to me, me I tell you the truth, it's the people who smoke cigarette to me, me not think very highly of them. Me I tell you the truth. Worse if you're a Rasta. Worse if you're a Rasta. Me not think very highly of people who smoke cigarette, you know. And me not think very highly of Rasta who say them smoke cigarette, because I don't know, I don't understand how a man can write that on the box. The biggest writing on the box, smoking kills. And him have your puff on something where him tell you, say, go kill you. I mean, what kind of ignorance is that? What kind of blissful ignorance is that? How them get you to do that? Suppose you go buy a brand new car. A brand new Mercedes Benz. And when you go open the car, in other words, it's your sign mark. Warning. Smoking in this Mercedes Benz will clog up the engine. You're not going to smoke in the Benz. You're not going to go and smoke in the Benz. And if a guy come in here and say, no, come in and come in the Benz, come smoke in the sign mark, no smoking in my Benz. You clog up my brand new Mercedes Benz engine. Your body is your body, is the only body you will ever have in life. You can't change your body. In the Christian doctrine, they say, knowing not that your body is the temple of God. If your body is the temple of God, and God lives in your body, and a man right on a box says, smoking, going to kill you. And you go and go buy the cigarette and smoke it. I bet a man just hang you. Put your neck on that guillotine because me not see how that possible. Me not see how that possible. That a man could have ignored something like that. If him make it and him tell you that, then why should I use that? mean, it's one thing if it's an accident. You know, it's like you sit on your side and you use your cell phone and it blow up on you. I mean, really. But for the man put that on the box, brethren and sistren, and you ignore it, so you know, so you get control. You really get control. So that is the level of control I'm talking about. That they make you eat things where you know it's not good for you. You know it's not good for you, you know. But then put you in a situation, you put you in a position like a 9-to-5 work. And this is how them set up them thing too, you know. A 9-to-5 work where you do have no time for yourself. Because by the time you left work 5 o'clock now, you're gone home. You're so tired that you start making TV all and watch you. When you wake up, you say, wait, me never know, say, right, the show, you watch all the show, and the show done, I never even know. And you wake up in the morning and realize you never lay down on your bed. The way you're tired. And as you get up in the morning, you can't even eat a good breakfast. And you pick them up to go to school. And you run around the place and talk, come drink your porridge, eat your biscuit, see your lunch money, you have to go buy. Me can't set up no lunch, you know. Tell the woman in front of the gate to buy some, get some chips and some luminous food. Where, hey, you see some of them food where the man selling in front of the school? If you carry it, go, where, you see some of them food where the man selling in front of the school? If you carry it, go, where the club up there's her name?
Shades.
Shades? It's supposed to glow. If you ever carry them food, you're going at some nightclub, man. You're supposed to look at the food like, wow, it comes from space, man. The glow is luminous, bright color. The Americanization of how we have sex. The Americanization of the entertainment where we entertain ourselves with. The Americanization of the clothes where we wear. The Americanization of the religion where we give credence to. That is what we call imperialism. And that is why many empires come and fall. Them never study. And you can't reach it, you can't, you know. For you reach the top now, where it's not there for going, you know. If you go walk, come back down. And all we are say is this. When you look upon our America set up, where everybody want to leave Jamaica and say they want to go to America.
Yeah.
So long ago, we had a one-room shack and the living was low. And my mama by herself raised me and my bro. Wasn't easy, but we did it with the little dough. Worked hard, got us up to school every day. And kept our eyes on the stars, though the skies were gray. Gave us drive to survive, really showed us the way. Now I really understood what she was trying to say. She said, son, there be times when the tides are high. I'm the bold baby rocky, you can cry. Just never give up. You can never give up. In this life you can lead if you only believe. And in order to achieve what you need, you can never give up. Oh, you can never give up. And in this hope that keeps me holding on, holding on. And this hope that makes me carry on, holding on and on. Homegrown, couldn't have made it alone. I got a wonderful life, two kids of my own, with a strong foundation that was carved in stone. Now my mama for the love that made my house a home. Made me wonder sometime if this is meant to be. All this for a humble little guy like me. And all I ever really wanted was a family. To teach my kids the same value that she gave to me. She's a son, there be times when the tides are high. And the boat may be rocky, you could cry. Just never give up. You can never give up. In this life you can lead if you only believe. And in order to achieve what you need, you can never give up. You can never give up. And this hope that keeps me holding on, holding on. And this hope that makes me carry on.
Yeah, Shaggy, talking about hope. My mother gave me that name, the last name, you know, hope. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM.
we not go retire. God not sleep and I'm a inspire. We have to reach higher, and that thing require. We have to make them up before the time is fire.
Yes, you know, this year is the 50th anniversary of the visit of Emperor Selassie to Jamaica. You know, and we have to remember, say, not only Jamaica and come, but I'm going to Trinidad and I'm going to Haiti. But it's a very important mark, milestone in the Rastafari movement, considering the persecution and all the atrocities that have been placed on Rastafari in the 50s. Come right up. To have Haile Selassie come here was really something else. Rastafari will celebrate the 50th anniversary of the visit of Emperor Haile Selassie to Jamaica. And there's quite a few different activities that is planned for this momentous occasion. We have on the line, my brethren who don't smoke cigarettes. Ras, you know, so we can't tell him no la political say my brother don't smoke cigarette. Whoa. So, we are laughing.
We give thanks, Muta. Yeah, man, there is always on the ball. We give thanks for the continuity and the strength done tremendous.
A brethren emailed me from South Africa. Him in a one of the posh era them in Melrose. In go there, you see, like them put out the chair them on the road and like him have some speaker when turn light speaker and I not big everything like in a Jamaica.
Yeah, yeah.
And pan it in play is a continuous playing up the cutting edge pan it. Continuous.
Yeah, man, great Rasta. The work probably reached places there I had never been. I traveled as the
eye.
Work has gone before, you know, and we commend that and we give thanks for the FM to for the even
of course,
put a Rastaman on board. We are say the things that no one to hear like that who fight Rasta. So special give thanks, Rasta.
A man make a product, a mark, say it go kill you and go buy it and go use it.
No.
You know, it's a madness, you know. It's most a madness, brethren. Mm-hmm. All right, let me talk about Barley. Let me talk about Rasta. Oh, a Rasta man could have gone in a shop, go buy a pack of cigarettes and see it marked smoking kill. Knowing where him know and knowing how him supposed to sit view the world. And make them catch him with that, Rasta.
No, terrible Rasta. I mean, that's why Rasta defined word, sound, and power. And make certain things and no, because the Rasta man say cigarette, you know.
Yes.
So once you call it cigarette.
Blind Garrett, you know, Blind Garrett. We used to call it Blind Garrett.
Yes. Yeah, all the names. So as Rodney did say, him learn one thing from the Rasses, that there's a connection with word, sound, and the power.
The power of the word, man. Yeah, man.
Yes, Rasta.
All right, so
as I hear the I refer to the blessing of the 50th anniversary, the diamond, is the golden jubilee.
Golden
jubilee. And, you know, we give thanks to Dr. Eric Williams, because he was in the forefront of even extending that invitation that brought His Imperial Majesty from the 18th April 1966 to the island of Trinidad.
From Trinidad,
and Tobago. And trust me, when you look back at the pictures of Trinidad and see how the government prepared Trinidad, Piarco Airport was like a kaleidoscope of colors of red, gold, green with the people them intermixed. It was a beautiful welcome, you know, on the part of the Trinidadian people. I mean, Rasta really never did it like that. So, you know, say it was a people's welcome. The Orthodox Church was near great welcome. I mean, Dr. Eric Williams was the man of the moment, having seen a manifestation of the king's arrival with the people. Yeah. So that was great.
All right.
But so we know even Haile Selassie the first now was looking forward to Jamrock, because coming to Jamrock, this is the place now where a people say God Almighty come.
And then they have some people where did come did visit him already in Ethiopia.
Exactly.
And then I was to see them again like a planner.
Plano and Carlo, and Alvaranga and the others.
Yes.
was eager, like any other, with the anticipation. But you know, him did stop over in Barbados, because Dr. Barrow did ask His Majesty's, like, tears did not see him eye, because Barbados was then a colonial territory.
Still is.
And with all of that appealing and all, His Majesty, you know, with the love in him heart, stopping in Barbados, spent about 2 hours, you know, and then they had wanted him to stay on, and him said, no, can't stay no longer. I have a mission in Jamrock. I have to go. Then we know what happened after that. Pandemonium, Palisades International Airport, Rastaman with chalice and the plane as cliff and lightning and thunder and rain.
But, you know what vexed me with all certain reasoning when me hear people that chat damn foolishness all the while say,
yeah.
When Haile Selassie say the madness we are going there, I'm afraid to come off of the plate. Haile Selassie is a man who go through war. I mean, when I prize him country and all them way there. And him, you're going to tell me, him used to lax, because lax is somewhere in Ethiopia enough. And I'm going to tell you now, say, him did free that the rest of them.
Joke thing. Those who don't know Ethiopia, know Ethiopia's history, don't know the caliber of person Haile Selassie is.
Yeah.
We're having Batawi priests as ancient Congo Nati up in the mountain top. And there are more tribes in Ethiopia where we are locked.
Of course.
His Majesty met the Maasai and the great warriors of Kenya.
All of them.
The dreadlocks Congo. So when him said dreadlocks Congo, and he met Martin O'Plana and had reasoning and dialogue. But who was the man when the government could not restore any order nor nothing, there was no representative of the government that could talk to the people. His Majesty said, Carl Rasmartimo Planner.
Yes.
So Planner for that moment was the ambassador, the representative of the people of Jamaica to Haile Selassie the first.
Yeah, man.
So if him betrayed the Rasta, or him saying go for the Rasta man.
And but him sitting with the Rasta man in him palace and talk things where
exactly.
Up to now we still don't even know where Imam Planus, well some of the things that we know, but some of the things that we don't even know where Imam Planus sit down and talk about over the years.
Well, those elders would tell us, and that is what, you know, the surviving ones will tell us now, that they, in the presence of the king, they recited Psalm 9, and for the ones who can go read over Psalm 9, go read it and see what those ones recited in the presence of the king when they met him at the palace.
Yeah.
So 1966, very phenomenal, unprecedented, never before in the history of the world. People converge on an airline, and there was naked flame. The Daily Gleaner said, lucky the whole thing did not blow up.
Yeah, the thing says it's going to blow up, because the amount of light, the amount of chalice we are lighting on the plane with all the gas and all them things there.
I mean, Eddie Siaga said never see that before. Everyone who were on the tarmac can say there was a fear. The fear factor was there, but when the crowd decides that we're not going to wear Rasta, decides that Haile Selassie I come and all that, that's phenomenal. And to be celebrating this year, the 50th anniversary, we know the format. We just want to bring back to the youth them today who don't know, because many young youth don't even know what it happened with Haile Selassie. There's so much rumors surrounding the
pure case. More rumor than reality. Yeah. I couple programs back, I did mention that I went down to right at Palace Theatre there, so.
Yeah.
On Victoria Avenue there, so. When the thing passed. And it was like, seeing Haile Selassie was of no significance to me at all at 12 years. It's just the excitement of a man come, and you know, everybody there, and me was a little youth to run up and long. Say, boy, we have to go down little. But it was of no significance to me. And when we go up in that stadium, and all me was, I mean, never interested in him since, you know, me was interested in the police, them had them antics, the dancing, we are going up on the ground and everything. That's all me interested in that. And for things, say, years after, like 7 years after, 6 years after, up to this day now, Haile Selassie is the center of my being.
Selassie,
the reason why I am who I am today.
To think that, man.
I tell you, man, it's amazing. All right, so tell me something now. We could go to where really the event, them, the events.
All right. we know, from time immemorial, we give thanks to the ancients of Rastafari, because these calendar events is always highly rated. Mm. Yeah, we don't miss coronation and birthday and visit, so we have always been doing this. But for the Naya being the order, we have always on the milestone occasion, like this 50th, we did in the 45th and the 25th and all, we have always enacted the whole route of His Majesty's arrival. Yeah. Mm. So we go to the airport and remember the moment, speak of the moment, the mystic of the moment. We remember even in the 45th anniversary, we're just out there at top about the mystic of the moment and see a red, gold and green just circle the sun. It was so spectacular. Everyone, police, visitors, every car stood still when them hear the roar of acknowledgement in just seeing that glory that came out in the 45th anniversary. So the 50th, we're going to do the same. We're going to go out there. But the only difference this time is that the grandson of His Imperial Majesty, His Imperial Highness Prince Hermia Sahle Selassie, will be coming to Jamrock in the morning. So the night prior to that, we'll be at Scott's Pass on the 20th, where we open a night of chant, Naya Bingi drums and chant and preparatory reasoning for what will happen on the morning. Come on, we want to leave Scott's Pass here about 7:30. We don't want to hit the highway, so we want to come through Maypen.
Hold on, you're too fast. Wednesday the night when we're going to go at Scott's Pass.
Wednesday, the night of the 20th.
Yeah, so for me, now in the morning, you know, like 10 o'clock.
7:30 a.m. while leave Scott's Pass, journey, Maypen, Olaba, Spanish Town, into the route to the airport.
Manly airport.
Yeah, so airport is a must. We want to reach there by 10 o'clock. The prince is supposed to arrive at 11. By formalities, VIP lounge meeting and all, we want journey from there, say, about midday. Mm. And then straight on to Eros Park. Mm. You know, Eros Park, His Majesty had paid a visit there when the Lea Reed and all at the monument for those who died in both world wars. But we had sent upon Garvey, you know, acknowledging Garvey for Garvey's contribution. You know, Garvey, exceptional when it comes to organization, one of the greatest black organizer where we have ever seen. I don't think the world had ever seen another man like Garvey, in the second to none in his field. So we are acknowledging him as His Majesty did, and the prince will read at his shrine.
All right, hold on. Because you have a whole heap of anecdote going on. So we want concentrate upon the motorcade. You said the motorcade going to leave from the Norman Manley Airport.
Yeah.
It going to move, go to where? Where it going to?
Eros Park. It coming straight.
Oh, so it now go to the Park. University first?
No, we're not going to university first. We're taking the Eros.
Oh, it has stopped at Eros Park and then go to Michael College.
And then Michael, you know, Michael just up the road. Yeah, and then JC. That was visited by His Imperial Majesty. We hope to even get a look at the visitor's book that His Imperial Majesty signed when he went to Michael College, one of the oldest institution, teaching institute we have in the island. Yeah. And His Majesty blessed them with his presence.
And then you're going to go to Jamaica College.
We're going to go to Jamaica College after. Yeah. And, you know, we just want to find, you know, if there's someone where, you know, is known to be there at the time when the king was there, we understand that...
Jerry Smile didn't used to go there. No? No, let me stop going there from them time. But Jerry Smile used to go at JC, you know.
Yeah, Jerry Smile, I heard he was a Jamaica College student with a life. They have a student who at the time was here or even a teacher if he's still living. We can even give him memoirs of that.
You must can't find somebody. You must can't find somebody. Must.
You know, I heard that Bruce Golden was head boy at the time.
Oh, yeah, we're going to get Bruce Golden to talk about it, man.
Yes, man. I really want to talk to Mike Barnett or Jelani or anyone who can contact Bruce. Or Bruce, I listen to Cutting Edge. Mr. Golden,
you said he was the head boy,
as we heard. Yeah. It would be nice if we can hear your recollection of the King's visit, you know?
Yeah, and then you go to UTech now.
And then you go to UTech.
Yeah.
You know, His Majesty visited UTech.
It was chaos at the time.
Leaving Yeah, leaving Kias at the time. Leaving there now, we went off. But right at UWE, you know what? UWE, His Majesty received this honorary doctorate of law degree.
Yeah.
You know, so we went go there, and then we went culminate right at the ruins, you know, that place, will identify the ruins where we have with Naya Bingi drums and chant and testimonials of all the ones who had seen the king from that time. And we invite the people to, it's not just a Rasta thing, because we know enough mother, grandmothers, youths who were blessed by his presence with debout and want to talk what they saw, because in 1966 there's no individual who tells that the king never looked upon them. So we want to hear all these testimonies from the different ones. And you know, His Majesty had medal a number of races, about 32 representative of Rastafari were medaled by His Majesty. When them check say His Majesty are going to denounce we, His Majesty medal 30 of the races at King's House, and I think there's only two of the survivors, two recipients of these medals that are surviving. Sam Clayton and I think Gabriel Selassie. Sam Clayton is one of them. Would it be nice to have these two angels should have come and we can recognize
Emmanuel was there. Prince Emmanuel was there.
Exactly. So. He was one of the recipients of these gold medals, you know.
But really and truly now, you know, say King's House is the only king ever going to King's House.
The only king to visit Jamaica, and not only that, the only king to go in a King's House.
And that was the time when Rasta going to King's House.
The first time.
Yes.
There's a Baptist lay preacher from Maypen, say he was invited to King's House. And when he went there and saw Rastafari with them drum, and when a policeman accosted the Rasta them, so they think, you know, smoke no ganja up here, and create a thing like what they do at the airport, a police superintendent passed and hear him and say, leave them alone. Them bad come and you want to come disturb them.
Yeah.
You know, so eyewitnesses, there's so many things that happened. It's just the first time Rasta was seen in what they would call high places among the dignitaries of the society.
Jamaica,
you know, and they say any individual who was not seen talking to a Rasta man at these receptions felt as if they were in no man's
out
land.
Of it, them out of
Rasta
it.
Was the center of attraction.
Yes.
Haile Selassie placed Rasta in a position that they were never placed in. Because, you know, we had the dung of the earth and, you know, the rejected and the despised. But
all right.
Haile Selassie brought a sense of respect.
This rally and testimonial and speech, I think, I go on till in the evening, like 7
o'clock. Yes, this will happen till about 8 o'clock in the night. You know, there about, sometimes we say 8, but you know when them drums and chants.
10 o'clock
at the
night. 10 o'clock.
We have an international representatives coming in, you know, because earlier the 16, 17, or 18, there are ones coming from New York, from Colorado, all over South Africa, Barbados, Guyana, you know, and these are the ones that we hear of, you know, and I understand that there will be a Nigerian representative coming in also from government.
All right, apart from the symbolism of this relative, what is the purpose of him being the symbol at that rally?
Prince Hermias?
Because it is His Majesty's relative outward.
Well, we invite all to come, you know, not just to have one who is part of that bloodline. I mean, if David was here as the one who was here in 66 who came with His Majesty, then he would have been the grandson of choice, because then he could tell I and I what happened inside the airplane when the plane land and the king say there's a throng, a gathering, a run towards the plane. We would have heard that. But because Prince Hermias is the head of the Crown Council and as the Golden Jubilee gathering, it is fitting that at least we can extend an invitation and say, come feel a so part it's, of so what it's,
is him coming here by himself, or is the Rastafari brethren them invite him? Hold on.
Well, it's Rastafari brethren through the university, because, you know, Mike Barnett has been one brethren who has been closely linked with Prince Jeremiah. I remember participating in programs in Florida University, where he was invited to speak at a Battle of Ottawa celebration. Yeah. So that link has been made, and it has been consistent. So fitting that we have a member of the family that's participating in a event that
What happened at the 12 tribe? What happened at the 12 tribe?
Well, you know, all mansions of Rastafari will celebrate the visit in their own way, and we just wish that at some point in time, like even in the motorcade on his arrival, that I and I can reminisce that moment together. And thereafter, we can, you know, probably branch into our own thing. But we know the 12 tribe of Israel, and I know the prince would want to visit them too at the HQ. So it is slated that on the Thursday, the night after the function at UWI, then, you know, something will be happening.
Wait, based upon how I look upon you, so, you see?
Yeah.
After the testimonials and the thing up at the university.
Yeah.
It's a 9 p.m. 12 tribe of Israel celebration. So I ask now if the ones them who going to be at the testimonial speeches at the university. Is it now that this thing going to now lead to the 12 tribe of Israel? Are you going to have ones who's 12 tribe go 12 tribe of Israel place, one who Bobo go back to Bobo place, one who is Mnaya Bing go back to Scott's Pass? How it going to work? How it work?
Well, I planned, we decide that after we complete UWI, then, because the Mnaya Bing will be ongoing at Scott's Pass.
I and I will
leave forward for enjoying one who at Scott's Pass to continue the Mnaya Bing vibration.
All right. So that
sealed the first night, the first day of the arrival, and then on Friday, now, you know, we rise up at the Mnaya Bing Tabernacle in preparation after a night of chant and the whole vibe.
So,
to leave out now to be now at Haile Selassie School, you know, the prince is supposed to give a lecture on education at the school. So we just have fellowship there at the school, because, you know, His Majesty laid the foundation stone. My biggest concern every year I go there, I try to find the foundation stone and can't find it, and nobody can tell me.
They must have cement over that. They must have cement over that already. They must have cement over that already, man.
So,
the amount of cement to drop this already, the amount of cement that over.
Well, I wish it was preserved, because they have a king. I mean, that in itself should be preserved. It was set in a corner where if you even a refurbished, you can preserve it, because it have its history, you know?
All right.
So Friday we'll be at the school that time, and then in the evening now, say about 6 to 8 p.m., we have reached forward.
At the university.
Yeah, I see. There'll be a lecture by Prince Jeremiah. Same way at UWI, and then in later on in the evening now we have up the photo exhibit, nice collage of photographs from 1966. I mean, I am seeing some of them prior to, and I've never seen these photos.
Never will leave them, you know.
All right, nice. So probably once you have the motor, you can
as a matter of fact,
make some of them available.
Wait, as a matter of fact, I bought some from GIS years ago when I was keeping the photo exhibition at my shop there. I had a photo exhibition for about 3 days. I went to GIS and bought a lot of them.
Well, the price you paid back then is a different price today.
Okay.
So hold on to your collection.
Hold on to them. I tell you, man, it's like my baby you're talking about.
All right. So you know, a treasure is the eye of Rasta. Would I like to see them too, because some of these photos.
Hold on, brethren.
Yes, man. So, you know, sealing up at UWI after the presentation and the viewing of these Isle of Full collage of photographs and an exhibition of Rastafari commemorating the visit, you know, because that in itself I go bring to light to many ones, and I invite the youngsters them to come out to, because you know we hear things, but seeing is knowing, and having the knowledge of what took place in 1966 is key to I and I. You know, because sometimes we hear the testimonials them out, and sometimes them not consistent, and we are credible testimonies that speak truth to what took place in 1966.
All right, which part up at the university the evening program I got take place Undercraft Fine and level one.
Yes, ones will be aware. It's the Undercraft, and then that is one era earmarked for one of the event, and then over to I'm not too sure where the photographic exhibit is, but I'm sure ones will be aware once we enter the campus. Ones will be made aware.
All right, so which part
the exhibition will be?
Which part the reception after what we call it?
The reception will be right at the venue where the after we have the exhibition, then we have reception follow after. Once you're there, you're there.
So you don't know where the exhibition is going to keep? You don't know which part of the exhibition I'll keep it?
No, no, not sure. I don't know if it's in the library area or where, but we know that would be an inside even, probably.
All right, so the reception, I'm going to take the farmer. What's the farmer, the reception?
Well, you know, reception after the whole happenings, then there's meet and greet, food and drink and welcoming and all. You know, drums and chant and all that will happen throughout, you know.
Okay.
So the night will end there for Friday night. Most of I and I would return to different mansions thereabout. We're going forward to the Bingi with our international rep, because the Saturday now will be the day when His Majesty would have laid the foundation stone at the school. We now would have departed into Montego Bay, and looking forward now to being at Pitford Naya Bingi Center. We know the Idrins in Mobile is also planning a reception, a nice rally in Sam Sharp Square or at the Civic Center, both. So, you know, welcome ones coming in, you know, on the Saturday evening. Then we retreat now forward to the Naya Bingi Center. At the Naya Bingi Center Saturday night, you know, the ISIS continue, where we are looking forward with the many international Naya Bingi representatives in the place. We will have to take time out now to reason, because after the festivity is serious reason now as to the way forward for the Naya Bingi order, with all that is happening within the movement. How can we now consolidate our efforts in one? His Majesty's speak of the brotherhood and the unity, where there is African blood, there is a basis for unity, and talk about collective working, and OI and I have to come together, organize, centralize. So there will be a reasoning that goes on from there during the Bingi, and looking at the Naya Bingi guidelines and see how we can put measures in place now to stem sometime the follies will take place, or we can chart a course to succeed in generation.
All right, so Sunday
that itself will seal up into seven lights, where we will seal in Montego Bay.
Sunday, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, a special service.
Yeah, there'll be a special service, because Prince Jeremiah would not travel along to the Bingi with I and I, like, and into Montego Bay. So because he now, as an Ethiopian, he would want to be at church Sunday.
He's not going to be in Montego Bay at all. He's not going to be there.
Yeah, he's going to Montego Bay, but not on the Saturday when we depart from the Naya Bingi Center.
Okay.
He would leave after the church service at the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, then he would head on to Montego Bay.
No, wait there. When me have in my hand, it says Sunday, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church.
Yeah.
Is a special service at Maxwell Avenue.
Exactly. That's in the morning.
Yeah, but and Saturday now, you're going to have another service again at the Ethiopian Orthodox Church when I visit.
No, that's the Sunday. The Saturday, I and I would be on our way to Montego Bay.
Yeah, so may I ask, you know, if now come on Montego Bay Saturday then?
Yes, man, not Saturday, the Sunday.
You may come on Montego Bay Saturday after the service?
After the service, he would head to Montego Bay.
Okay.
And then, you know, the prince would want to meet with the different houses, so we trust that all that happened now when he reached Montego Bay and can be at the Bingi and meet with I and I there too as an order, yeah?
Well, that sounds comprehensive. That sounds like a comprehensive vibe that go on there.
Yes, man. And I mean, sealing up with some serious reasoning, because the international community is coming. They are aware of what is happening on the ground. And, you know, once I look forward for a oneness, a unity, and, you know, just putting things in place that we know the do's and don'ts, you know, because sometimes things creep up on we and make we look like we're not together, you know, but His Majesty know that, yeah, we have to get it right, because our Father is the Father we talk about.
Well, right,
the brotherhood of man, and if we not do these things, we fall short of His teachings, yeah?
Yeah. All right, Bridget, you know, we have to go move, you know, like, you know.
Yeah, man, love and blessing, man.
Hold on, before you go, man. We want to talk, we want to mention Coral Garden.
Coral Garden now is the 25th, Bad Friday.
That is next week.
Bad Friday. So we implore all ones.
Really, when are the 25th?
All road lead to Coral Garden at Jarrett Park.
That's on next week, Friday.
Exactly.
Okay. I will
all road lead to Coral Garden. So some youth out there will just hear the thing and not know what it is all about. The youth them forget engaged and come out to these events, come hear these testimonials, be a part. It's your thing. Be a part of it.
Well, you know what's very important about this year now is that the public defender, after she have done giving our report, important because over the years that we have been gathering in Montego Bay, it was all leading up to the public defender and what now is going to happen when it is given into Parliament. Because we have over there have been lobbying fight and people have said, well, you know, every time we go at this thing, you have the same thing when I do over and over. But it's very important that we understand how you must use propaganda at your disposal.
Exactly, in a positive way. Garvey talk about it.
Yes, using propaganda.
And we have to remember, I start here, boys, like the season plant has become fruit right now.
So, why may I say that? We cannot say that. You know, it's like when people are saying, why about Rasta? Every day on all say the same thing over and over. I mean, it's not nothing, but things is happening.
They don't see where we usually smoke the weed on the gully bank and talk all these things. Your brain food and look now. Your ministers me here at that about ganja with food and now.
And I try to ease out the Rasta too. They might try to ease out Rasta too tight.
Exactly. So I want to push me aside.
So we must know, the race is not for the swift, not the battle for the strong. It's who endure.
And the one who endures.
Yeah, and we must understand. We must understand, say, our cause is just.
Just, yes.
And even though it might look like we are keep saying the same thing over and over, and I do the same, it's not that we are doing the same thing the same way all the while, you know. But we are continuously using what is at our, which is not much. We don't have much at our disposal, you know, but we use what we have.
But constant agitation has given us the picture of good over evil.
Yeah, man. So we give thanks, Bridget. We give thanks
for the
continuous move where I make also. By the way, where your brother? Oh, your brother, man.
Ibo in South Africa, you know. Ibo in South Africa, you know. Ivy in Canada, and did I look forward to come join I the gallery and hope it happen. And you know, Canada look forward to their 50 years next year, because His Majesty visited them in Expo 67, so Canada will have their Golden Jubilee next year. So Ibo is good in there in South Africa. I knew him didn't want to come, but you know him have ties to Ethiopia like that, but him good.
Yeah, all right, sir. Give thanks, Virgin. Give thanks. Yeah.
Love and blessing, Mota. Rastafari.
Yeah, man. We've been talking to about the different things that will be taking place to commemorate the visit of Emperor Selassie I to Jamaica 50 years ago. 3 years. But it's really weird, you know. 1962. Them say Jamaica get independence. 1963, them brutalize Rasta. 3 years after, Haile Selassie come to Jamaica. It's a very serious, serious thing. 1962, them say Jamaica get independence. 1 year after, on the 6th of August, 1962, Jamaica get independence. 1963, April, 1963, Bad Friday. Them brutalize Rasta for 3 days. Rasta get brutalized. 1 year, almost 1 year after the independence celebration. 3 years after Emperor Selassie I come here. You know, say, in 64, 65, them say Haile Selassie dead. And that was supposed to end the argument about Haile Selassie. By all them use, by the logics where people use, you're not supposed to have no Rasta in a Jamaica right now. Yeah, you're not supposed to have no Rasta in a Jamaica right now because Haile Selassie is supposed to be dead. And if you got dead, where the use you talk about him again for? Well, make I tell you something. Listen to this carefully. From my barn, I hear my grandmother talk about Jesus. Was supposed to live 2,000 years ago. Say, I'm going to come back. And for 2,000 years now, I ain't not seen no Jesus come back. And them kill him and put him upon a cross according to them story there and put him in a one tomb. And them say him raised from the dead. Plus, hundreds of more people raised from the dead too. Now, if you read the Bible carefully, you will realize, say, when them say Jesus Christ raised from the dead, them have a little part of the story, say, ye men of Galilee, why stare it in the sky? Because same way the Son of Man Graham shall come again. Warm to the hundreds of people where they raised out of the coffin, them out of the earth, when him did raise, according to the story were written in one of the book them. Where are those people now? Because them never go up there with him. Which part of them there? 2,000 years ago we are talking about, you know. Where them people there, there? If them did raise from the dead. Where Zachariah, where Lazarus there? Lazarus, who did that stink in him tomb? Jesus said, go inside and take him out. And say, Lazarus, come forth. I don't know if him come third, fourth, sixth, or fifth, but which part him there? Where him is? Where these people is were raised up out of the ground on the day when Jesus Christ come out of him tomb, where is it that them say, them witness people that come out of tomb like the Walking Dead movie? But yet still, the Mac and J Rasta. Rasta on the God dead, on the damn foolishness, but you know, it's on the God dead. We don't have Mac and J nobody. We just have say, if we use the logics, if we use the logics we Uno use, we'd have to figure out now which part Jesus there. From my barn, I hear him in the sky. I don't know why I'm sitting up there so long. I don't know why I'm up there so long. Maybe I need a change of clothes right now. I'm sitting up there too long. Anyway, and now I can't hear nothing, you know.
The history of black hair. Our hair story. The history behind all elaborate designs and hairstyles originated in different ethnic groups in Africa. The first known example of dreadlocks date back to ancient Egypt, where dreadlocks appeared on many artifacts. Ancient Egyptians with dreadlocks have also been recovered from archaeological sites. Socially, hair grooming played a significant part in status and identity in African tribes. It was a way to identify someone's social status based on ethnicity, social rank, age, marital status, wealth, fertility, manhood, religion, and death. Twisting, braiding, cotton or wool thread weaving, adding animal fat or mud and clay were all techniques used to create these elaborate looks. Due to styling taking hours and sometimes days, much like today, women use this time of beautifying as a chance to socialize and form meaningful bonds with one another. In 1444, Europeans began to kidnap Africans of all social statuses and trade them on the west coast of Africa. Many wore elaborate hairstyles. Although the Europeans were first entranced with and admired the complexity of style, texture, and adornment of black hair, something had to be done to rid them of their identity to maintain control and dependency. Many slave owners shaved not only the men's hair but women's hair as well. This was considered an unspeakable crime to many tribes. In 1619, the first slaves were brought to Jamestown. After being on a ship for 3 months in unbearable conditions where hygiene, let alone hair care maintenance, couldn't be maintained, many of the enslaved Africans' hair was matted upon arrival. The enslaved Africans were no longer allowed to speak their native languages, do traditional dances, and maintain their hair in the styles that they chose. All of the African culture and grooming traditions began to disappear. Slave owners wanted to cut off the enslaved Africans' connection to their true self. They pushed their standard of beauty, fair skin, straight hair, and thin facial features. African dark skin, kinky hair, and wider facial features were deemed unattractive. Because of this, lighter skin, straight hair slaves commanded higher prices at auction. Due to brainwashing and internalizing color consciousness, many blacks promoted the idea that dark skin and kinky hair were less attractive and worthless. The enslaved Africans were given no way to care for their hair. In the 1800s, without combs and the herbal treatments used in Africa, they were forced to use bacon grease, butter, kerosene, and sheep brushes to maintain their hair. In 1845, metal hot combs are invented by the French and available to the United States. Many people believe Madame C.J. Walker invented the hot comb, which is incorrect. She developed a range of hair care products for blacks and popularized the press and curl style. In 1865, slavery ended, but the emotional and psychological scars lived on and are still evident today. Quote-unquote good hair, or hair that is finer, curlier, and closer to that of Europeans, becomes a prerequisite for getting jobs, entering certain schools, churches, and social groups. In the 1920s, Marcus Garvey, a black nationalist, urges followers to embrace their natural hair and reclaim their African aesthetic. He is quoted as saying, "You must remove the kinks from your mind, not your hair." In 1954, George E. Johnson launches a permanent hair straightener for men that can be applied at home. A women's chemical straightener quickly follows. In 1962, actress Cicely Tyson wears cornrows on the TV drama East Side, West Side. This was a big deal because braids weren't considered a finished look for an adult woman. Usually this style was only worn inside the home. Angela Davis became an icon of black power with her large afro. The afro became a symbol for black power and pride. Kinky hair and dark skin is embraced, and the phrase "black is beautiful" is coined. In 1968, Diane Carroll is the first black woman to star in a television network series. She is said to be the black version of the All-American Girl with straightened curled hair. In 1971, Melba Tolliver is fired from the ABC affiliate in New York for wearing her hair in an afro. This caused a great deal of controversy. In 1977, the Jerry curl exploded on the black hair scene. It was deemed a curly perm for blacks, and the style lasted through the 1980s. In the 1990s, Essence magazine declares sisters love the weave, but natural styles on locks are starting to become more accepted as well. In the 2000s, relaxers, braids, and natural styles are explored by African Americans. Around 2009, there is a surge in the number of women wearing their hair naturally. Many refer to this as the natural hair movement. In 2006, black hair care is a billion-dollar industry. Black women consume 80% of the hair industry, but only own 3%. Keratin and Brazilian treatments are marketed to smooth and straighten natural hair without damaging the hair. Naturals soon to find this to be false. Today, black women are wearing their hair in a variety of styles, both relaxed and natural. The number of women wearing their hair naturally has increased significantly due to the education on the harshness of chemicals used in relaxers, scalp conditions, a desire to lead a healthier and more active lifestyle, and a desire for naturally longer and thicker hair. Many believe to truly embrace, understand, and appreciate our hair, especially in its natural state and how it directly relates to our culture, we must understand its history and be willing to maintain a certain level of integrity and respect regarding it. I wasn't able to list everything, unfortunately. The video would have been way too long, but I encourage you to continue to research about this subject. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see y'all next time. Peace, love, and light.
cool music, Larry Marshall. Cool, cool music. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM. You know, a group of people in America where, may I tell you, say them bottom, I go tweet, 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 is the gay people them with Donald Trump. I mean, like, I mean, them supposed to, hey, believe you me, no, you know, say, me wouldn't be surprised if they shoot Donald Trump. No, I'm unsurprised, Rasta. Me unsurprised because, may I tell you, man, you see how the gay community, them supposed to have fret like fret, you know. Because you see them conservative people there, they can't take Obama there with the thing about them legitimize what them call civil union, you know. And you see the Ku Klux Klan are three things them eat, you know. Three group them eat. I mean eat. Black people, Jews, and homosexual. Black people, Jews, and homosexual is hated by the Ku Klux Klan. So you see when Trump get legitimized by them and Charles Manson. that one there, the wickedest one, you know, sir. Believe you, you know. Charles Manson turned Christian, you know. I tell you, say, if you're young and you don't know, you hear more talk about Charles Manson, go Google Charles Manson and you see who named Charles Manson. Believe you me. You know, so one time them say Charles Manson was the devil. Yeah, man, one time them used to say Charles Manson was the, like, is the reincarnation of the devil, you know. But in a Jamaica now, them say a Muta. Because a man called me. You know the man, you know me there? But I ever tell you this, you know. You know, so I'm up at the university that day and a man come inside me and say, hello, good afternoon, good evening. I say, I know you don't know who I talk to, you know, but I am the man who called you up on the radio and say, use the Antichrist reincarnate. I say, I look for the Bible and say, all right, I you name, so his name Olaba. Some Olaba I come from, I say, man, that's a Gilligan's gear. But me, I tell you, everybody, you know, say Reagan, Ronald Reagan was supposed to be the Antichrist because of him name. I think him have three names, they have six letters in it. You know, say Obama, them say Obama are the devil incarnate. I mean, like, how much devil can vote the place? So? It's the 666. That them refer to in the New Testament is Nero, Emperor Nero. Them say Nero fiddle while Rome burn. That 666 relate to him, Emperor Nero. But the 666 gets so popular that all of the Pope them hold the brand of the 666 by with my boy name again, Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King, Martin Luther the German. Martin Luther, the German Protestant, started protest against Rome and end up now the 666 be the papacy. And then you have a woman, Ellen G. White, now she come and legitimize it more, writing a book named Revelation and Daniel and the Revelation, and interpret it to fit the Roman papacy. So the idea of the Pope being the Antichrist, you know, is really Martin Luther and the same day them come up with these things. Because little old man, the Antichrist. And hey, somebody don't like gay, you know, and everybody, a Rasta man can call Pope gay, like, I mean, like, wow, when we just start being gay, you know, every word will come out of Rasta man's mouth and be gay, you know, lightning for the Pope. Pope, they never use a gay still, but it's the other word them use, BM. But really and truly, the Pope get some terrible bad name. The Pope get some terrible, are the Popes, because the Pope is really, is a title and a seat, a position, is a title and a seat, a position. The papers is a position in the Vatican City. As Mila Tilly say, the Vatican City is one of the richest countries in the world. And we have to call it a country within a country. They are Italy, it's in a Rome, but it's not, it's totally independent of Rome and Italy. You can't, it have its own guard, it have its own seat, its own bank. It have not to own everything. And you can't, I mean, hey, we go to Vatican City one time in Rasta. I was saying that they have a demonstration. Well, every Sunday they come out, every Sunday the support come out from the balcony there. We and the man, them, me and the musician, them decided to go down the car. We used to the Pope come out. Come, we want to experience this thing. Yeah. You know, me not like just a read things and I see things on TV. Me want to experience it. So when we go down there, you know, when we look at the place, you know, it's like how we are loaded as black people there. That all camera, anyway, the camera them there, you know, you can just feel the eye them, you know. And you can just feel it so the police them are drawn near to you, you know, that me I say, no, sir. When the Pope, when the Pope come out from the balcony there, me never feel like tense up. Because I realize, you know, we were forgotten in the audience, we were forgotten. But trust me, man, every kind of people where you know are demonstrating against something was there demonstrating against the Pope. The biggest group of all was the gay community. The gay community was in its full force in a St. Peter's Basilica, in the outdoor place there, you know. So where me I say that is, we say this, that the perceptions where we have, that's what I talk about, how we are controlled and manipulated. We are controlled and manipulated because a man who them claim name John sit down on an island and write a book. And the book when write named Revelation. And people in at this time yeah, read a book there. And everything in the book there relate to something we are going with him around here. So. Things will happen years ago. Things were, I mean, like, if you check out the Jehovah's Witness and 7 Day them, you know. 7 Day talk some things where in a Revelation and Daniel and the Revelation where this woman named White did write, you know, where suppose it come to pass dozens of years ago and it not come to pass, you know. Remember when they talk about the world are going to end and this world are going to end and that the world are going to end and every time they talk about the world are going to end, you know. And them dead and the world still not end. The point is that we are so, our mind is so claustrophobic. You know, our thinking is so claustrophobic that we allow these people to put things in front of you and then interpret the thing how them want it to be interpreted and place it in front of you as truth. As truth. So when I want to write a thing against a government in a fame time, a man writes something, you know, and it related to the government in a fame time, you know. And years after, the man never intended to be transcendental, you know, to keep going and going, you know. He was writing about a situation in a fame time. A man coming at this time and read the same thing and relate it to an individual in a fame time and say, it, a damn man that I talk about. And we can see that in the whole idea of what we just talk about, that there was a time when Ronald Reagan was supposed to be the mark of the beast because he named them, I don't remember his middle name, you know, but Ronald, R-O-N-A-L-D, and Reagan, but the middle name was supposed to be 666, and that's how people interpret it. And you couldn't tell the people, it's like the man 2 years, 3 years ago, said the world is going to end. It was the biggest thing, people sell them things in America, and decides why the world are going to end now. This is it now. This is it. See, it's still a gwan, yes, sir. It's still a gwan. The world end with me dead. I just saw it go. Me just have no more part to play in the world. When me dead, that's the end of the world. Each individual have a own end. I don't know if there is no, unless man gets so cruel to nature, and nature have a way, because you can't destroy nature, you know, but nature will destroy you. So maybe man do something to the atmosphere and create some devastation that nature just decides it's going to destroy human being and start over again. Yes. And man, our man metamorphosed into a different kind of creature to fit in plastic world. So when him create a plastic world where certain things can't happen again, in order to survive, him just adapt to that plastic world and become a different kind of creature. Yes. So, we know as African people, it might look like when I say yes or no, don't make no sense right now based upon how we are going. But down the line, certain things going to make manifest. And we not talk like no seer, no prophet, no this or that, you know. It's just a logical deduction. You know, it's not like a man who had tell you about the weather, him have any great spiritual awakening or any great, you know, internal, you know, manifested light to shine and bright him up. But him study, scientifically, him study the thing. So you use mathematics and solve all problems. Mathematics work. Mathematics work. And one of the times really why we can identify certain things is because we don't know the equation to solve that thing. Everything is a mystery until you understand what make the mystery work. And then it no longer become a mystery. So there's a whole heap of things that we used to say is mystery. First time when people drop down and flat upon the ground, people say, devil take all of them. Now we know say epilepsy. Take all the people, like you can't take medicine for the epilepsy. First time a man do that, them said, left him. You know, see the devil possess him. And you know, help him. No, you see a man, well, nowadays people are helping. A man crashed everybody and said, let me get a picture of him. Move. Nobody touch him. Not touch him. Let me take a picture first before you take him up. But there was a time when people have epilepsy and people feel say devil take all in body and not do nothing about it. And in Europe, it was a big thing in Europe. You have certain diseases that take all the people in Europe because they couldn't control or have no cure feed. Like the Black Plague. Yeah, we played the documentary about the Black Plague in England. In Europe, it killed 70% of the population. People actually believe, say, the people them who never believe in a Jesus, it caused a plague to come along upon them. So them start to kill the people them who don't believe in a Jesus. And they become a plague in themselves. Can you imagine? You see a plague go on and you look at and say, you know, say a true man next door not believe in a God. A Rasta, you know. A Rasta, that's why the plague coming, you know, we go kill him. And you go and go kill the Rasta. Because he say him cause because he not believe in a Jesus. That is the backwardness where you used to reach people. And still I reach people now. Human beings still in another level of thinking there. So, we have a far way to go. We have come from far, but we have a far way to go. And we need to shake up yourself and realize, it's a mind control thing going on. You have a small group of people. No, what heap of people need, I know. You have a small group of people will decide the fate of the world. Small group. White men. Not no black man no involved in it. You know. No black man no involved in it. It's white men. A small group of them will sit down and manipulate either through the media or through food are through clothes, are through sex, entertainment, they manipulate the thing. terrible thing. This is Lenny Ebert, one made popular by a man named Johnny Little. Village Carla. Local music. Hey, you know, them stop use xylophone in a music. Anyway at all. Especially, you could all mention xylophone to all some youth, you know, and them are trying to figure out where you get them foolish them name they from. Xylophone is where you listen to right now. Lenny Ebert, the Village Carla. And we are take the call of them now, the Village call of them, we can come in with the call them.
Dismiss a lot of the Bible. And what about the mark of the beast? You can dismiss that too.
Who are dismiss it? Me not dismiss it.
If you said that what happened?
No, me I say that a whole heap of things were written. I'm not ready because the writer who did I write it was writing it bit up half a while he was experiencing in a film time. But people take it now and put it in at this time, you know, like say, it's this time I talk about.
Yeah, but where I said the mark of the beast now is after manifest now because now you have...
Then all you know, but all you know, to the man who did that write it was not talk about the mark of the beast in a film time.
So that dismiss it can't happen now.
What can't happen now? The mark of the beast?
Yes.
Yeah, but maybe you can use the same terminology if you use something that happened to you in this time, yeah. But matter about the man who are write the thing. The man who are write the thing, I write about where in my experience, I'm not write about something that got happen 500 years from him write it.
Yeah, but what I'm saying to you is that we have to say it will happen now because...
What
will
happen now? What will happen
now? They might dismiss cash now. So,
But that don't mean that you them might dismiss cash now. It relate to where the man did that write. Are you going to interpret it that way there?
I suppose you can't use any language you want.
We're wrong with dismissing cash. You have less teeth about the place. In that Sweden, no, 40% of Sweden is cashless. You have less teeth. Maybe the beggar them have to go walk with the ATM machine.
So what about the part where say you can't buy or sell without you have it?
Of what?
The mark of the beast.
What is the mark of the beast?
One mark where you have to agree with the this thing, you have to take a mark. You have to take a mark.
No, wait, no man, not tell me about mark. Me ask you, what is the mark that you're going to have? What is the mark?
What is it particular? Let me say one mark on your forehead or your right hand. That's what it say. One mark. Whatever.
But you keep how it look. Mark.
The point is, you can't take place in the market, or you can't take part in the marketplace without it.
Without what?
Without you agree to take the mark. What is so hard to understand about those words?
No, but you know what is hard to understand? Because you keep saying mark and don't tell me what is the mark.
I mean, what it look like?
Bridget.
The name of the beast or the number.
So who is the beast?
Who is the beast?
Yes.
Lucifer.
No. So who is Lucifer? Who is Lucifer?
Lucifer is a demon.
Point to him.
Spirit, right. Just like.
Oh, is that spirit?
Yes.
So Lucifer.
Yes. He's a flesh man like.
Okay.
Well, he's a flesh man in terms of the Pope, but apart from the power behind the Pope.
But is that me just try to tell you, sir? It's a man sit down and a group of people sit down and tell you, sir, the Pope, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You come to that understanding based upon power where somebody did right. Said this is the Pope. No, I tell you, sir, when I'm a mark of the beast, the number of the beast was once referred to Emperor Nero of Rome. Mm-hmm. The mark of the beast was once referred to Ronald Reagan. There's so many people that come that people say this is the mark of the beast. You get the mark of the beast as the Pope coming from the Seventh-day Adventist and from Martin Luther. You never come up with that. A man interpret that for you and give you that and say, the mark of the beast is the Pope. And if the mark of the beast is the Pope, how is it now that you still sit on your throne and talk about the mark of the beast is Lucifer, is a spirit, and all these things? It's a confusion to put on your head. It's a confusion. Because the mark of the beast, according to them, is a man. Knowing that the mark of the beast is a man and his number is 666. That is what it's saying in Revelation. And right. I said to you, how you get it to be the Pope is because a man interpret it and give you it as the Pope.
No, is because it say is a mount, is the city with that sits on seven mountains.
Which city sits on seven mountains? Tell me which city sits on seven
mountains. Rome.
Then that matter say the man who did I write it is Emperor Nero and did I talk about.
Okay, so you said the mark of the beast never happened then?
I don't know if it's something to going to happen, Bridging. The mark of the beast is supposed to be an individual man. It's a man it's a talk about, you know.
It's a that no man can buy himself without you take the mark.
The beast.
Yeah.
Is a man. I know that this man, the number is...
Another Pope.
Oh, you know.
The spiritual ruler of the world.
Who's the spiritual ruler of the world?
The Pope. All nations who, bow to him.
How foolish is that, Bridging? All nations bow to the Pope.
Which nation ever know?
No nation.
Check him.
Bridging.
Come to Bridging. Every president meet
the Dalai Lama.
When he come to your country, he meet in a secret with every leader.
It's foolish you're talking. The Dalai Lama has been to every nation. The Dalai Lama.
And he meet in a secret with every leader.
The Dalai, you know who is the Dalai Lama?
Yes, man.
Who is the Dalai Lama?
I know him, yes.
No. Who is the Dalai Lama?
He is from Tibet.
Yes.
He is the spiritual leader of them.
He is spiritual leader of them. You don't know, say, he meet every leader in the world.
Him come here too?
No,
okay.
Never come here. This Pope come here yet? Him come here? The Pope?
Yes, him come here one time, yes.
This Pope you come here, sir?
It doesn't matter which one, just the Pope period. It doesn't matter which one.
No, the Dalai Lama going to come here too. I know one Dalai Lama.
No, man, 50 years.
I know one Dalai Lama. No, wait, I know one Dalai Lama them are bridging. The Dalai Lama is a
seat. At a time.
Wait there. The Dalai Lama is a seat prepared by the Buddhists, them, you know.
Yes.
All right.
It's their spiritual power that, yes.
Yeah. So I tell you, sir. You saying the Pope is Lucifer. It's telling me nothing because every man will sit down in the office of the Pope. You're going to tell me, say the devil. Every man will sit down.
He is the representative.
It's foolishness because the 1 billion people say he represents Christ on earth and next billion people say he is the devil. It's foolishness. It's foolish.
Different people say different things. No, you say one thing and next, and so it's ideas. It's a battle of ideas.
I don't say nothing about the Pope, whether him is the devil or whether him is vicar of Christ or not. I do have no concept of devil and I have no concept of vicar of Christ.
Yeah, I know, because I'm here,
when you say the Pope is the devil, and you're going to say, no, every one of them is the devil. And that you're telling me, you know.
The power, the seat, the throne.
The throne of the Pope is the devil throne?
Yes.
All right, so let me ask you a question now. Where is the throne of the opposite of the devil now, which is God? Where is
that would be King David.
Where is the throne? Where is it?
The last time it was in Ethiopia.
The last time?
Yeah, that's the last time. When the king did it. Was alive.
Oh,
it was there.
So all the emperors of Ethiopia is God.
Is is God?
No.
No.
All the emperors.
Is God.
Wait there. Follow the logics. Follow the logics. If all the popes sit down in the seat of the devil, and you just tell me, say,
The office of the devil.
The throne we are talking about.
Yeah, the same thing.
Yeah, and now you just tell me now, say, when I ask you what is the opposite of the
King throne. King David throne.
So King David throne represents the seat of God.
Yes, therefore, on earth.
Therefore, every emperor, every king was sitting in a David throne is God.
Mm-hmm. Representative.
Yeah, God, represent God.
And God himself still, you know, is for him office.
No, don't repeat the office. Me understand what you're saying. Me, I said to you, okay. You have the opposite over there, sir, which is the Pope, which is the devil. Mm-hmm. And you have the opposite over here, sir, which is the emperor. Anybody who's sitting in a David throne is God, represent God.
All right, yes, okay, all right.
No, is that you say, right?
Me not say him a God himself, because King David dead, and all the kings were sitting upon that throne, they're dead, and no king no dead now.
So you know, so the Pope now is not the devil then? Him just represent the...
Him represent.
So the Pope is not the devil then? Where you laugh?
When you do the work of the devil, you are the devil.
When you do the work of the devil, you are the devil. What kind of foolishness is that?
Yo, brethren,
so the devil is not an individual. So the devil is not an individual person then?
It's a spirit. It's a demon.
No, a demon is what? A demon is an individual thing?
A demon is a power.
All right, so God is a power too.
Yes.
So the Pope represents that power. Demon power.
Yes, demon power.
And the kings that were sitting in the throne of David represent God power.
Yes.
All right. So
But you have some of them where do wrong.
Yeah, hold on. So you have some of the Pope them where do good then?
I don't know none of them. I don't know.
No, but follow the logics now, Virgin.
If you say you have some of the emperor them
in the throne of David do wrong, so why you can't have some of the Pope them do good?
Okay, all right.
All right, so may I ask you now, in the Bible now, where you get them reasoning there from?
Yes.
The Bible say that know that the beast is a man. It never say him is a spirit. It say him is a man. And his number is 666. That is where it says it's a man. It never says that spirit.
Not to read it again to make sure.
Oh, you mean make sure? May I tell you what it says? Revelation 13, it says the number of the beast is 600. Know that the beast is a man.
I remember that, but okay.
All right, we'll go back and read it and call me back, yeah?
All right, Mr.
Yeah, blessed, yes. Take it.
And there's one thing you have to get through your mind and keep it. Nothing that ever came from the European mind was meant to do anything but facilitate European domination of the world. Everything, every idea, every so-called religion was meant to dominate and to control. You were the ones with the illusions. Why is it that you were so naive? You let people redress something that you invented, sell it back to you, and enslave you through it. Our relationship with the people of the world and the fact that we created peaceful nations that had no word for jail because no one had ever gone to one. No word for old people's home because no one ever threw away grandma and grandpa. No word for orphanage. We did all of this. And over half of human civilization was over before we knew that a European was in the world. Before he wore a shoe or lived in a house that had a window. Now Africa has always and still is the prize for the whole world. We have always been the prize because we have always had and still have something that other people won't, think they can't do without, and don't care to pay for. Because we have always been the prize, we have been under siege for over 3,000 years. The main thing imperialism did, slavery and imperialism, they removed African people from the respectful commentary of history. When they discovered you, they began to prey on you. And what we have to understand now in the period of superior brainwashing is there is no European answer for African problems. Either Africans find a solution to African problems or there is no solution. And if you don't find a solution soon, you go back into slavery. We have to stop all of this nonsense about who belongs to what religion when all of them were imposed on us in the first place. We stop all this fight between Muslims and Christians when neither one of the religions are doing them any good or moving them toward independence. All of them are handmaidens of conquerors. All of them are religions of conquerors. We were naive when we accepted their interpretation of something that we had all along. I'm saying we need to take a good look at ourselves. I'm not talking about burning churches. I'm not talking about getting rid of religions. Understand me well. I am saying that every single thing that touches your life, religious, socially, and politically, must be an instrument of your liberation, or you must throw it into the ash can of history. We've been the victims of propaganda. Now the Bible that you get so dewy-eyed over is one of the greatest pieces of propaganda ever written. If you want to read the Bible, why don't you read the Bible one day and read Mein Kampf the next day and see the comparison? That's hard on your mind. Because you think if you don't have Christianity, Islam, or Judaism, you don't have that spirituality. I've got more spirituality after I put all of them down. A lot of people need to stop reading some religious books and read some straight history. Without faith, fable, without supposition, without myth. Read straight history. The Europeans doing the slave trade not only read the African out of history, they colonized history, they colonized information about history. That what you have to do is take a holistic look. Now that, not only at your position in the world, but your potential in the world. But if there are a billion of you on the face of this earth, scattered all over the world, what do you need with a friend other than yourself? Why can't you turn inward on yourself and say, I will wear no clothes I don't produce. Start with your underwear. I wear no shoes that's not made by a brother. You're creating a shoe factory, employment at once. Start buying airplanes, break them down and study them, later on make airplanes. What this whole thing is about is the restoration of confidence. It has been the role of these handmaidens of colonialism to destroy your confidence in yourself. We produced the first human society that said you can't be a king unless you got a queen. You can't be a god unless you got a goddess. We got confused with someone else's ideas, someone else's concept and definition of us. What we have to understand is that faith has not spared us for an idle reason. What is there in us that made us strong enough to take this heavy blow? 500 years of slavery, one way or the other. Slavery, neo-colonialism. What made us strong enough to survive? What has faith saved us to do? And inasmuch as we gave the world its first humanity, faith has saved us to give the world its last humanity. What we have to do is to believe it, to believe that we are worthy of it, and to believe that we are capable of it. What black studies should be about, what black religion should be about, is the restoration of the confidence. And the restoration of the confidence is we must rule the state again. Then, in coordination with other African people throughout the world, we will give the world a new lease on life. We must answer the call of the great African-American poet, Margaret Walker, who said, let the dirges end, let a new peace begin. Let us write a new covenant for the freedom of ourselves in the world. African men throughout the world need to step forward and answer Sister Margaret and say, Sister Margaret, we have heard your call. With our women at our side, we are ready to pick up the challenge. We are ready to start a revolution that will change the world. We won't get ready tomorrow because tomorrow's things are left to tomorrow. We will start our revolution right now, and we will start it with ourselves. Thank you.
I don't like when I talk a man go like something don't know me, I say no. My brethren looked for Revelation a while ago. All right. Scroll. Oh, you, what kind of backward computer is where you can't touch the screen and go up?
Me,
yeah, I want to go up. So much beast are going on. I saw second beast, second. Anyway, all right, go back up now. Go back down. All right. Brethren, the brethren who just called me a well. In a verse 18 of the chapter where me I read, I think a chapter of verse 13, Revelation 13. This was written by a man, them credit to a man named John. He said, this call for wisdom. Let the person who was inside calculate the number of the beast. For it is the number of a man. And the number is 666. Now, how much more argument you want to get? Calculate the number of the beast. So when them say beast, it's not really like a dragon. It's the number of a man. Them just use beast as a metaphor. Right? They might use the beast as a metaphor. Because it's more than one beast they might talk about, you know. Because it's more than one beast that come out of this. Whatsoever it come out of. It's a... This beast force people to buy, great and small, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand and them forehead. So them could not buy or sell unless them have the mark, which is the name of the beast, of a number of its name. So you are going to calculate now the beast, them say. So they could not buy or sell unless them have the mark, which is the name of the beast. The number is the name of the beast, you know. The number, which is the name of the beast, are the number of its name. It said, this call for wisdom, let the person who reading this calculate the number of the beast. For it is the number of a man. That number is 666. Now, my argument is this. That the seventh day, which is Miss White, calculate this thing and give you it as the Pope. She has also made some other things reference that was going to happen and never happened, you know. She's the prophetess of the seventh day. She's like the goddess of seventh day. My boy, her name, Martin Luther, German, come up, break away from Rome, just like Henry VIII, from Anglican, Protestant, come up. The man who is writing this thing, say, the beast, the number of the beast is the number of a man. I don't understand why I must interpret that. So if there's number of the man, I say him never said the number of men, you know. It never said the number 666 is related to many men. So don't put something we're doing there, you know. It never said, let who have wisdom calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of many men. And their number is 666. It's a singular. Man is the number of a man. It never said the office. It said the beast is a man. This man will cause you not to buy or sell unless you have the mark. I'm going to issue a mark that represents him. This man is now saying, no, if you don't have this mark, you cannot buy or sell. Whether you're rich or whether you're poor, whether you're free or whether you're a slave, you must have this mark. I'm going to put it on either your right hand or on your forehead. So if you don't have it, you can neither buy or sell and let them have the mark. Which country in the world right now we buy and sell in a guan, we have a mark on your forehead? And the man said, but it not happened yet. I have said to you that the man who write that story was experiencing something in a theme time. That's why I'm saying, this is the number of the man, the name of the man is the number, and the number is 666. The same day them calculate in a Latin, because them use them use letters instead of numbers. Them calculate that the vicar of Christ, where the popes them represent on earth, where more than 1 billion people believe that this pope, or any pope for that matter, is representing Christ on earth. Them say, when you calculate this vicar of Christ argument, it come up to 666. I have said to you that Ronald Reagan name did come up to 666, and people used to say him was the mark of the beast. Him was the beast itself. The man is a man. I do understand why I must use what them tell me now for have a clear understanding of myself. I have a search now for Kai Wap now. 50 years from now, you know, people are going to say the same thing, you know. It's like when a man, it's like when, you know, the Bible says, there are many who stand in here that shall not see death until the Son of Man appear. It says that, you know, there is many here, this is where it says, him say, the man who stand up there say, there are many here talking to the people them who is there. There are many here who shall not see death until the Son of Man appear. People have said the Son of Man not appear yet. So where the people them they were talk to? Them dead long time. Them not there again. Them dead long time. So that story that comes is null and void. Nobody come twist and try twist around the target, twist the argument like you try to cut off your foot for fit the shoes. You can't cut off your foot for fit the shoes. The man said, there's many here that shall not see death until the Son of Man appear. The people, them whom I talk to, dead already, and the Son of Man never come. It's the same thing with this. The number of the man, that number is 666. Why should I now sit down in a feed them logics now and I say, well, all the popes represent the beast. And him is going to manipulate the world economic to the point where now, if you do have this mark, you can't buy yourself. It's foolishness. It's foolishness. And maybe I could have didn't want to believe it when I just left school, but I'm not going to believe it now because I come to understand things clearer and I realize that it's something them put in my head. Them put that in my head to make me say, all of the Pope, them are devil. Born the Pope are the devil. And any Pope who come now, me say the Pope are the devil. How much devil them have seen of the Pope? And to follow that brother logic, that means everybody who sit down on the throne of David of God. And me not see that. Me not see that. But me not tell you if you go accept that. Me just say, me not use them logic say if you come decide my thinking. The man who did write that, I don't know where they live, but I know say that man they did write it based upon something where they happen in a theme time. Cutting edge.
Blessed, Mota.
Yeah, blessed.
Yeah, man. You see, a lot of people really can't reason out of the context of the Bible, you know, man. Because everything them braces back to devil and demons. And
I don't know why we have to do that. Why we have to do that? Why we have to talk about everything is demon? Devil, when we ask him what is demon, he says that spirit. What the hell demon, demon or spirit?
This religion is a powerful thing, you know, man. And what you do to black people, you know, man, it take with that fighting power and put it for with me, you know, man.
Yes.
Because we are looking for a mark on the forehead, you know, and, you know, them the days they're out now, you know, man. You know what I mean? Them create a system we can control for a long time, you know, man. We lost the system, you know. We have to try and gain back ourselves, you know, to us. Spiritual perspective,
brethren,
and knowledge of who we are.
Of course, but what you know, brethren, you see, meanwhile, you look for mark in your forehead and in your hand. Them I use them television, them I use them radio, them newspaper. Mr. Murdoch, I use him television, him radio station, them. Him I use all the things them that is necessary where him knows they use in gross in for brainwash you.
It's a psychological thing, you know what I mean? And we don't understand that. And when we sometimes when I talk to a person about God and certain things, and you tell them, say, well, you don't believe this whole religion thing, them start saying that devil and that you're born to hell. So how we reach this far, we have to understand that we as Africans, we have lots of gods, you know. The whole story of God is just rewritten and given back to us, you know. And we keep worshipping and running behind the European gods, running behind the Arab God. And it's like we lost our system, you know. I read this book, you know, called The Secret of the Freemason.
Yes.
By Elijah Muhammad.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm reading
it. And in the book he said, you know, one of the founding fathers of the Freemasons said, you know, he will do everything to block the light that would lead knowledge to the Negro mind. And when you talk about light in the Freemasons, you know, you're talking about knowledge.
Yeah.
And education, you know. A lot of us, you know, is a truth, you know, because we lost, you know. We can't get back that strong spirituality and this African consciousness in a way, you know.
Everything that is African is demonized. That is why what I want to say. And it's a demon coming, yeah, you know. Anything African, that demon.
That's why you see a lot of people now, them try them beat themselves because they want to look like the God they have in their house. You know? And then start do certain things that really not really a part of them, you know what I mean? Them start to adapt a more European cultural thing, you know. And anything African is considered to be bad or considered to be something that is buffoon.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We not have that. We need to get back ourselves together, you know what I mean? And this whole system that controls us is man put together and design it so that we don't leave where we are. Once you step out, you step back in, if you keep having this spiritual devil mind or this thinking of somebody's going to burn you when you die or if you don't do this or do that. You know, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Right. Black people need to come together and get themselves.
Warm to our things. Warm to the things that we didn't know. Before the Greek them and the Roman them translate. Not translate, but give us. Not even translate. Give us this thing where them call New Testament. What we did have?
But if you look at it, you know, about that, all of this religion thing coming out all the way from Egypt, you know, through the Hebrew way, you know, because we Egyptians are black people, you know, but you see this finding that they're finding nowadays, it's straight in the nose and trying to make the jawbone look like they're white. We were the founders of gods, you know, we have lots of gods back in that time. What they do, you know, is changing over, because Christianity is a counterfeit religion, you know, it's a rewritten religion, you know. If we have to trace it back to the Egyptians, you know. But what them do now is reread it and give it back to us.
Yeah,
and we accept it.
Yeah.
And we accept belief and we throw away the fact in the bin.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We cannot think out of the context of religion.
Can't, you know, think out of it, Regin. That's why we lose. Anyway, we have to move.
Yeah, man, give thanks, huh?
Yeah. This is the cutting edge. Tin boy, you see, you make me cut out the one of the adverts, but all right. It ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast. Why Brian left me with the chapter yet to write it, who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. The second beast was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast, so that the image could speak and cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. It also forced all people, great and small, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead, so they could not buy or sell unless they had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of its name. This call for wisdom. Let the person who has insight calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. That number is 666. Now, I put it to you that this calculation was not done by you. It was done for you. What me say? The calculation that is written in the book of Revelation was not done by you. It was done for you. And because it was done for you, you now declare that the person who did the calculation for you put it on a group of people And they don't see me, them just say black people are one fifth of a human being. Black people is not real human being. You have white people in the days of slavery. We did believe that. And them turn to the Bible to validate this thinking that black people is not really human beings. Them is beasts. They are beasts, they're not civilized. So them create laws. Slavery was not unlawful. Slavery was not unlawful. It was a legitimate interaction of business ventures with the British people. It was not unlawful to have a slave. Nobody was saying slavery was illegal until we're down. And people use the Bible to justify that. Slave must be obedient to his master. Now, the man who read that, you know, because him have a slave now, you know, he might use that and put it in a theme time and say, the Bible says slave must be obedient to his master. So I do have no understanding of myself enough to come realize that is foolishness. But because the Bible says slave must be obedient to the master, no, I must take that now and say, but the Bible says it. The Bible says slave must be obedient to his master. So where's the end of slavery? If the Bible says slave must be obedient to his master, why should slavery end? Because all who is slave must be obedient to their master. Yet still I now say that I don't accept that. I see it in the Bible, but I don't accept it. I do accept that. Does not nature teach you that for a man to have long ears of shame? I don't accept those foolishness. I don't accept because the Bible say it is a shame for a man to have long ears. I must say no, boy, right now it's not the Bible, you know. So I now go wear my child, I go ball up my like my bottom. I do any of those things. So a man will come now and go show me now, say, the Pope is the devil. And I think pan it, you know, and I think I say, all the devil, all the Pope, a billion of odd people see the Pope as a true representative of them spiritual awakening, spiritual manifestation. Right? 1 billion odd people is Roman Catholic. Even black people become Roman Catholic. That is so mind-boggling to me. It's so mind-boggling to me that a black person can see them as a Roman Catholic. And now, I go come and I say, but wait, think out this thing in a motor. Think it out seriously. The man who write this, was he writing it for your consumption? I was writing it based upon how him view him social order at the time when he was writing it. Was he writing this thing for me to come now 800, 900 years after for come say, is America, is Ronald Reagan did attack? If the situation is similar, but that don't mean it's the same. Not because something look like something means it come from the other something. It's madness. It's a madness. Because me and you do the same thing. It means that you may follow. And I said to you now, say, within the logics, I now go follow where a man has said. Without really analyzing it myself and realizing, say, but wait, when this man is a write it, you know, it's not me I'm talking about, yet like, he has his similarities in a way, man, say, in my position. In a, my situation, I can't look on it and say, well, you know, say the man say this and the man say that. I can't look on my situation and say, well, the same thing the man they used to say in at them time there, you know. See it now. But I now go take the thing. A, B, C, D, F, G, H, I, J, K, I come say, boy, at that, where the man attack, I mean my talk about. At my time, I talk about. You see the beast? The beast is where him talk about, right as or now. The Pope. Every Pope now, I go bear the brunt of a doctrine where some individual, where some woman come up with, or some guy in a Germany come up with, and start to tell you, say, boy, it's madness, it's madness. Warm to our African retention. Our Africanness, where we come here with, where them beat out away, where make we accept for them things. The Greek and the Roman, them write down something. And them tell yourself, why four people, the four different people. The most important book, well, Paul is the most important book in the Bible. But make us say Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is the most important books in the New Testament. Who write it? Who write it? I don't know who write it. The Bible don't tell you how who write it. People want to tell you, say them know who write it. But not go so. Maybe it's the same person write the four of them under different names. And draw from one, draw from the other, one draw. Because I can't see the scholars them know Matthew was copying from Mark. Mark wasn't the first one that was written, it was Mark. Sorry, Matthew wasn't the first one was written, it was Mark. So how Matthew become the first book in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And now the material say, but it's Mark first it write and Matthew a copy from it. And the possibility that the only one that was never copied was John, because him start film statement totally different from everybody else. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word taken to himself and dwell amongst man. Totally different from the other one of them. I try to show you a genealogy and a chronology of things that don't go so. Is that America do right now? The America do the same thing right now in the election, you know. The same people them who institutionalize the doctrine will keep down one group of people and uplift a next group of people. We're sure you say white is right. We're sure you say right now black people is one fifth of a human being. Where did I lynch black people here and there and there, and I take out them testicles and I put in a back and carry it home as souvenir. Where did I walk around and I lynch people in a some little clown looking white clothes and believe in a Jesus and tell them I do it? When them lynch a black man, them pray. And the same people them right now, I run and I tell you, say, boy, right now, this man here, he's a madman. Donald Trump is a madman. Donald Trump is not a madman. Donald Trump is the epitome of what white America represent. And I try to dodge it. And I try it against him now, because he might bring out of them what them really is. And them eat for see that, because right now when you look by yourself in the mirror sometimes, you say, boy, I'm just become a look so. No need to go watch my face, right? Look how much matter in my eye and all them things there. Donald Trump is the matter in them eye. Donald Trump is the man now who watch what them say. But watch a man. I saw what they think all the while. No, when I fight against man, I saw what they think all the while. It just true me not have me never got to no big university to go study which word for use this and which word for use this. Huh? But the same thing when I think. It not have nothing to do with the mark of the beast over there, so. The man that done calculate out the mark of the beast in a film time already and done work out film thing and dead and gone. Simple. Him dead and gone. Him not John not have nothing to do with nothing right here, so. All this little them do, the conservative people them, including, which is the Christian-minded people them, which is them are support Donald Trump. The Christian-minded people are supporting Donald Trump, because the Christian-minded people is the one them we a try instigate a Armageddon according to what the Bible say. So in other words, they might cut off them foot for fit the shoes. These Christian people from Bush come right down to them time, the same conservative set of people them. Them want to create something in the world that will usher in what them call the battle of Armageddon. And then them say, but the Bible, they tell you already, say the Armageddon, that them do, you know. Them do it, you know. Them set up the scenario, and them tell you, say, them don't plan the Armageddon already, you know, but them write it in the book. Say, the battle of Armageddon, this is what we call the battle of Armageddon. And them study it, and them show it, and them interpret it for you, you know. Them interpret it for you. So you say, no, the Amagidian are going to come, you know. See, the Amagidian, everybody are ball out about Amagidian, Amagidian. Them are create that. Haile Selassie say, it's a weird thing, you know. It's a weird thing, you know. Haile Selassie say from in the, I don't remember, Muslim in the 60s, 70s. Haile Selassie say, Africa, Amagidian has passed. Haile Selassie say, Africa's Amagidian, quote me, say me said, Haile Selassie say that. Me have magazine, you know, me can show you that. Them say, Africa's Amagidian has passed. Now, if that man has said that as an African person, he might look upon the Bible and I say, this is where Amagidian supposed to be, you know. But he might say, why right now, our Amagidian passed. We don't have no more Amagidian to get Rasta. Our Amagidian passed. What is Africa's Amagidian? The destruction of black civilization, that is the Amagidian, the destruction of black civilization. And Haile Selassie recognize the destruction of black civilization, which include the raping of Africa and the taking away of their children from Africa. Him say African Amagidian passed. So what more Amagidian you look for? The only Amagidian that leave is the Amagidian where some conservative Christian people conjure up and decide they're going to leech it upon the world. And if that's what they're going to do and they have the power, you can't stop it. You cannot stop it. Because them is working in the interest of themselves. And that is what Donald Trump represents. Donald Trump represents the deepest core of the conservative element in America. The conservative element, whether them is Democratic, whether them is Democrats or Republicans, them share the same view, the same worldview. The control, power, that is what them serve. Them serve power, nothing else. You have to have power, economically, socially, religiously, politically. If there's any other lay there, you can work with that too. The mark of the beast catch the world because them interpret that and put pan a group of people too. the Christians don't like the Jews because them hear them say, is the Jews kill Jesus? And that's the argument to, you know. And so they must separate the world continuously, you know, for maintain white supremacy. For maintain white supremacy. Them have a thing named the Ku Klux Klan where don't like gays, don't like homosexuals, don't like gays, don't like black people, and don't like Jews. The Christian right, them say, it's the Jews, them kill Jesus. You have black people now where join the conservative right. It's them same one. Them same one fashion, the mindset of chattel slavery and the so-called Jewish Holocaust. The chattel slavery that has been perpetuated by African people, not only physically but mentally, is the same mindset that gave rise to Hitler, inner Germany, who was not a German. So when we talk, and when we talk about biblical interpretation, whose interpretation we're following? That is the argument. Who write it? When was it written? Why was it written? That is the question. Where? A brethren teach me that. Heal up my journalist brethren. The famous wise. When, where, who, why, and what. Five wise. Five W, sorry. When. When did it happen? Where did it happen? what happened, who it happened to, and where that away, letter W. Mix up in your brains and all. But we just show how things interpret for we over the years, and we keep repeating it and regurgitating it. Yes, cutting edge.
Yes, Muta.
Ah, blessed man. How are you, man?
Good, and me, I wish myself from now happy birthday for my birthday tomorrow, Friday the 18th. What you mean? What you mean? Me, I wish myself happy birthday.
No.
What you mean? Man didn't go and wish him own herself happy birthday tomorrow, Friday mean, the 18th.
Wish him, let no man come and say, I am the Lord your God, and no man must have no other God before me. Wish it is, what you mean?
What you mean? For real. Mm. Yes, and love my mother and father who make me come forward and thing. You see, everything what you've been saying about Donald Trump and thing, totally correct. Because he's only hypocritical and mentally enslaved Africans don't recognize Donald Trump for what he is. He is the honest face of the racist European
white supremacy.
As Malcolm X said, exactly, as Malcolm X said, there is no difference between a Democrat
and a Republican. None.
They're all crackers.
Yes.
Hillary Clinton pretending like she's different. She referred to our African youths in the States as super predators. She and her husband, Bill Clinton, rip off and rob money that them get that was supposed to be given to our African people in Haiti. She is a warmonger just like Donald Trump. And as you correctly say, with what Haile Selassie say, Armageddon, our so-called Armageddon passed because the destruction of black civilization, that classic book by Dr. Chancellor Williams.
Yes.
Read it. That is our Armageddon. And we as African people must stop reading the books by we are believing what other people write. As Marcus Garvey said in Philosophy and Opinions, nothing written by the European and non-Africans is designed for our benefit. Only we as Africans can write and interpret for ourselves.
Brethren, I can tell you something, man. Them have way in this book so much that them are talk about themselves and them own things, and we start to internalize it and I say, we them are talk about. We do just like the Constitution of America, we the people. It do have nothing to do with black people.
Nothing to do, because not at the time they view us as cattle thing, that we were 3/5 of being a human being, etc. Jefferson, Washington, and all of them so-called founding fathers were people who enslaved our ancestors in the United States, so-called. It was not the Constitution of the States was a racist constitution which was made for the English murdering settler colonialists who murder people and rape people.
Them rape
our boys and our men also.
And our animals too.
And the animals too, bestiality. This is what I tell people, you know. When you see them pushing, like Obama helping them, for the legalization of homosexuality and for teach it in the schools, and them doing the same thing in Britain too, for teach it from kindergarten level and thing. You see, once them get you, if they are allowed to get you full with that, the next thing is to legalize having sex with little children, you know. Pedophile and having sex with animals like dogs, goats, cats and that type of thing. These are degenerate people. Degenerate.
Brethren, I can tell you something, man.
Yeah.
You see, we know we cannot, you know, at this time, afford to interpret what has already been interpreted in the view of those people. We cannot now sit down and when them interpret it, we come now and use that interpretation.
Like it's our
thing. Like our thing. It's a madness.
Yes. It's of course, but it's madness. People like that, if them in Jamaica, them belong in Bellevue.
When a man, you know, say, Andrea Balico thing, which you always play, we say, the problem with it is that when a man use something and make you believe, say, where you are, say, is you really say it? And you realize about it? them done did interpret it for you already. Just like when I tell about LNG, what? She done put that in your brains already. And start a whole denomination in a Christianity named Seventh-day Adventist. In it.
Yes.
Martin Luther done interpret this thing already. And Protestantize the whole thing now. What else is there we going to interpret from that given thing already? They've done interpret it already. So all we have to do now is play like the zombie. We just use it for them interpretation and fall back on it every time we talk about it. It's madness. It's a madness.
It's total madness. And this is why one of the hardest jobs that people like you and I as Africans have to do, as Gaviites and thing, is to wean away those of our people who have been enslaved by their so-called religion of Christianity. We are anything outside of them so-called Bible and thing, they do not want to know, because it's a deliberate thing for African people not to know themselves, because when you follow that kind of mental enslavement of falsely believing that everything is in them so-called holy Bible, then it means that you will never try to know your own history, your own story, and what you are. So you will always be mentally enslaved.
All right. But you know, Bridget, I sit down and I watch this American thing, and I say, I hear the people that are grappling for, how is it that the conservative Christian, the Christian them, is backing Donald Trump? And then now we hear Ben Carson, who was like the most quiet Christian-minded person, the whole 17 people, him just start say, boy, him go back Donald Trump. People shocked at it. I said, why you shocked? Donald Trump is saying where the Christian-minded people them in America think. Because it's a Christian thing. Donald Trump is saying, is preaching Christianity, you know. Right wing Christianity, you know. It's Christianity my preaching, you know.
Yes. It's race, it's Christian, European nationalism.
Yeah, so all them surprised that the Christian them have voted for Donald Trump. I don't understand it. I don't understand all them surprised.
There is absolutely no surprise. The Armageddon, as you correctly say, that they are talking about, is that all over the world, African people in Africa, Brother Malema and others in South Africa, President Mugabe and others in ZANU-PF in Zimbabwe and elsewhere in Africa, the Chinese and other people are not tolerating European world racist domination. Mm. So the Armageddon that them talking about is to try to hold back the control that them used to have over the world in things. Yeah, that is for them Armageddon.
Yeah. Yes, man, Dingo.
May I tell you? Yeah, man. Yes, man. Because Donald Trump, for example, has refused. Some people find it surprising that Donald Trump has refused to condemn the Ku Klux Klan.
Mm.
There is no room for confusion. He has refused to, and he will never condemn the Ku Klux Klan, because he's a Ku Klux Klan himself.
But wait, no, a brother, an old man, elbow, a brother walk up a step. I don't know if they see it in England there, right?
Mm-hmm.
In a one I'm thinking them, a black brother walk go up the stairs and a brother come out, an old man come out and elbow him, lick him in his face.
Him thump him, him about 79 year old, me see it.
Wait, no, them interview the man and him say, next time, him go and kill him.
Yes.
You're the part right now. Donald Trump say him going to pay for the man court.
Him legal defense.
Legal
yes.
defense. You think so them easy?
Yes.
You think them
so,
easy?
So it's only stupid, idiot people don't want to recognize the reality of what is happening. But listen, what Donald Trump and others like him doing in the States, it's not strange. It's what the racists have always done from generation to generation.
Well, but you know what? You know what?
People trying to pretend like it's something new.
I think what them
this is how they are.
I think what them vex about is that him a quitting something when them don't ready for yet. It's like him a do something where supposed to happen, but it's not supposed to happen now. So them want to stop him at any cost. The only thing left for them
because
them
is that because him alert, the so-called victims them too early.
Yeah, so that means I say, so when you really check it now, you know, the only thing left for them is them assassinate him, you know, because right now I can't tell me them, I say, them now get enough, out of the 3 man them left, them now get enough delegates
for stop him.
For stop the convention. Because yes. Supposed to go, and them go to the convention, if him feel the person who have the most vote should have got you, them I say, is not so it work. Them now must decide against the people, the will of the people, you know. You have some set of man who sit down and decide, said no. Them go and go use somebody who never run in at the election, or who use one of the man, the other 2 man them, to make them represent the Republican Party for go deal with the Democrats. Donald Trump said, look here, which Rubio said that, the other one will lose that, said that, Cruz said, look here, if we don't make it go to the convention, you know, it's not going to be lovely. You hear what Trump come out and say that today? Say, anyhow, them make it go to a convention and him don't get him just... It's riots going on the streets of America. Because millions of people vote for him. I mean, like millions of people vote for him, you know. He must say,
but when
him, riots but, going
but
to
when him say that, you know, he's correct in making that statement.
Yeah,
he's
not a threat. Yeah, but they must see, they must look at it like a threat. Not a threat. It's a reality, man.
It's not a threat. He's just stating the facts.
Because then
you have millions of supporters.
But not only that, no. You're going to say democracy don't mean one L in America when it comes on a certain thing. Because watch out now. If them allow people who never vote to go against the wishes of the people them who say are Donald Trump, therefore, it's not democracy that. That is not democracy.
Exactly.
You can't come bring a little executive group of people to say, we don't like the line with Donald Trump are taking, even though he might win for we. But we don't like how he might win for we. So you're going to know. We're going to find a guy outside and come put him there, so now, and all you think the people are going to feel now? The people are going to riot in the streets.
Definitely, because what it goes to show, as you and I know for years upon years, is that this so-called democracy thing in Jamaica, in Britain, in the States and elsewhere, is a whole fraud, is a whole facade. Yeah. Them so-called use it when it suit them
yeah.
And when it don't suit them don't use it.
Yeah, it's like when Donald Trump said, in believe in the waterboarding, in believe in a torture. Because you can't have people, you know, you can't have people that chop off man head and I drown them and everything there. In believe in a waterboarding still.
Yeah.
They will say, no. I say, but watch out now. America has been franchise out in torture, you know. You know that,
They have been doing it. They have been doing it
them
for years.
Send the prisoner them in a certain place where them capture. Because them know say the people that come on it. Them peer countries where no business but no feel no way about torturing. Peer the country for torture the people them forget certain information out of the people them. And then no matter
yes, them
interested
yes, they do that with countries. Them do that with them send them to some countries in some Arab countries where
yes,
they have control
yes,
over and
yes.
That type of thing. It's true.
So when Donald Trump come out and say no, watch out now. I seen say we must torture people still. Because these people don't like we. They must say, no, you can't say that. But he must say what they must do already.
The thing about it is that he's not a hypocrite. Him tell it just like how it is. And is the hypocrite racist them who don't like that.
Yes.
Him say it just like it. Look for example, the Clintons them. Is under the Clinton presidency and thing. Them have this thing where them kidnap people in other countries and them have a fancy word for it. Them not call it kidnapping, no. Them call it extraordinary rendition. Now, if we in Jamaica, we in Zimbabwe, Ghana, or any other country of the world, send our intelligence services to other countries and kidnap
people
in other countries, you would hear all kind of things.
Yeah.
Eh? But when they do it, it's nothing is wrong. It is extraordinary rendition. So the Americans have been going around kidnapping
torturing
citizens of
people,
other countries.
Torturing people.
Yes.
Because they have been torturing people in Arab countries.
Yes, 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 yes. You know,
and they have been using them drone to kill children and parents.
Mm.
So it's collateral damage. And then when the man say when Trump say them should kill the families of the terrorists, them people say, no, this guy is a mad guy. But guess what? They have been doing that for a long time.
But they have been doing it, and they call it collateral damage.
Collateral damage, they call it. They say, one man, you want one. All right. Me see that happen many times, you know, especially in Yemen. Them are look for one man, you know, right? And the one man end up in a wedding. With no people there, you know. And just to kill the one man, them just destroy the whole people there. Just kill the whole of the people.
But you know what happened a lot of times? Who them claim that them want to kill, escape, you know?
Sometimes, yeah, true.
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah, that's another thing too. Who them want to kill? But you see, what happened? They do not view the people as human beings, you know. They view the people like the people are cockroaches and vermin. Yeah. So it's nothing to wipe them out, you know. It's the Adolf Hitler mentality, you know. And they claim that they're against Adolf Hitler, you know. But it's the same mentality, because for you to go around the world murdering other people, men, women and children, boys and girls, and you don't, and you just call it collateral damage, which is what you're doing. You are no different from Adolf Hitler.
Brethren, Christians,
what you condemning Adolf Hitler for?
Christians did help Hitler to exterminate the Jews.
Yes.
Christians help Hitler to exterminate the Jews, because them say it's the Jews them kill Jesus, help to kill Jesus.
Yes, but as you and I know, that is a scam for them to maintain them European racist business. And I remember when Mussolini's Italian army, before they went to invade
Ethiopia,
them was blessed in St. Peter's Square
by the Pope,
by Pope Pius the 12th.
The bomb them was blessed. Them bless the band, they forgot to kill them.
I'm bless the troops, the Italian troops in St. Peter's Square.
And the mustard gas that them spray over the country in Ethiopia and poison everything in its sight.
Yes.
The Pope
This is what the Roman Catholic Church did, who enslaved our people, part and parcel of the enslavement of our people. This is why some years ago, Peter Espute, who write for the Gleaner and that type of thing, and him write a thing about him celebrating the so much years of Roman Catholicism in Jamaica. And Peter Espute, Roman Catholic, he had nothing to say about the racism and the enslavement of Africans by the Roman Catholics in Jamaica and the other islands of the Caribbean and in Africa and elsewhere. He had nothing to say, Peter Espute.
But I had him have a reason one time, and I said, Mr. Bridging, as an intelligent man, who environmentalist, and, you know, I respect you as an environmentalist and all them, but tell me something now.
Yes.
You really believe, sir, when you eat the Eucharist and drink the wine, it literally becomes the flesh and blood of Jesus? He said, yes. And then he started showing me now how it's possible.
You're talking Peter Espute, you know?
Yeah, no, Espute, the man right on the paper, man, the environment.
Yes, man, he believes it.
Him say, him going to show me, him going to try explain to me now. In a themed way, scientifically, you know, how it possible that a wine and a bread can go in a your body and it become the flesh.
And become the flesh and blood
man,
of Jesus
of a
Christ.
Man who lived 2,000 years ago. Supposed to. This is an intelligent man, you know. We rate him as an intelligent person. I mean, talk about the environment, you know. I mean, ask about me. Something wrong with me, brethren. Something sick.
But Mota, I'm glad you mentioned this. You see, before I went to me and you meet up at Kingston Technical High School. I went to Campion College, you know. Peter Espute and I were in the same 1B, first form at Campion College, you know.
Then him so See? Young. Me never knew him so young. Might not around Peter Espute at all.
No, man. Listen to me, man. Peter and Espute and I started Campion College together. We were in 1B. Hey. Our farm master was Father Ralph Delaney. We had three streams, 1A, 1B, 1C. Is there something you know Alan Cole? Alan Cole, my brethren, used to come Campion too. And then him go very technical after. And you know, Peter Espute, you know what we used to call him? Because in those days I was a Roman Catholic because my father made me join it for thing. But what happened is, you know what we used to call Peter Espute? Right. We used to call him Father Boy, you know. Because he used to totally believe in where the Jesuit priests them say and with him holy business, you know. So what you tell me about him is to be expected, and several times over the years, he has, you say all the thing when me I tell you about him, I praise where Roman Catholics do and not talk about the wickedness and thing.
Yeah.
I write to the gleaner and make them know too that me and him go school together. So this is somebody who I know from Campion. And you know the gleaner refused to print my replies to him. But what?
But you see,
we have Cutting Edge, we have Mucha Baruka, so the world know.
Make tell you something. You see, when I hear the man say that, right at the studio, when we're at the studio, we have my company, you see, when I hear the man say that, I say, Mr. B, explain something to me. You, as an intelligent person, are going to show me some logical explanation that a man who you claim lived 2,000 years ago, when you drink some red, what them call it, red label wine.
The red wine.
Yeah, and you eat, when you call the, no, bread. The little bread. You are telling me, say, it literally in a your body become the flesh and blood of that man we live, where you claim live 2,000 years ago. Something wrong with me. Come in and tell him, say something
and,
wrong
and,
with
and,
him.
And him said to you, yes, not true.
Yeah,
without blinking an eye. He looked you straight at the eye.
Me never tell him, say something wrong with him, you know. Me tell him there's something wrong with me. Because
Wayne say.
No, the argument done. The argument done. Me and him not no more argument. Because me say, me can't believe an intelligent man like that. Still there and tell me that. So something was wrong with me. Me not have nothing to say to him. Something wrong with me.
Yeah man.
Anyway, Rafa move.
Yeah man. You just keep up the good work, because this work of deep brainwashing and of mentally emancipating our people, the Marcus Garvey and others before him started, it have to be a non-stop thing, because we have a ministry of miseducation in Jamaica. We still don't have Marcus Garvey philosophy and opinions in the school system, and that is why I ran it with Sadaboy named Johnson Rhodes Scholar like him. Tell what he lies about Marcus Garvey and African reparations and a PM pan it at the same time. I'm big up to Jerry Smart.
Yes, yeah.
Hi, Muta. Renee from Proudly.
Oh, you look rotted. I think he was in Jordan.
No, man.
Or China or something.
No, remember I told
Maybe
you
North that Korea. Me, I thought he was in North Korea.
Why you want to put me over there suffer with them, the crazy people there?
Well, I just see them old American. They had given 15 years to take that thing out of the hotel.
No, anytime I go across my Jamaican passport, my travel with Jamaica, I have more diplomatic relationships with those people than America. So I don't play those games. I was listening to the conversation with you on Mandingo about Donald Trump. You know, there is a book. And you can get it on YouTube. It's called The White Man's Bible. And essentially what it is that far-right Christian doctrine, unapologetic about the white man's position in the world. And Donald Trump, you know, he really embodies that in the rhetoric that he's bringing. And I'm going to tell you that I feel like me just have a feeling, say, Donald Trump is playing everybody. And the reason why I say that is, to date, Donald Trump himself has yet to write a check for marketing or advertising. Every time he says something offensive, the media goes crazy. They put him in front of the camera. What's he talking about? No. He's appealing to...
You know what that means? That means him is a great businessman.
He's a great businessman, and he's manipulating the devil out of that low education, low average third grade level mentality of middle America.
Yeah, but wait, I can explain something to you.
It's not only those people attracted to him, you know. I tell you, say these Christian people who's well educated is attracted to him.
Yes, naturally. It's not just those people alone, but at the same time, for a long time, no, this is someone who's saying what they want to hear. Yeah. If someone started to say, you know, run out these people out of office because they don't even put in water in the hospital, we're going to gravitate to that person with that voice. Everybody has a voice. Everybody has a consensus of people who will actually listen to them.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, so if him jump up tomorrow and say, look, I'm going to start worshipping a scorpion, there is going to be a dude somewhere in America who is going to say, yeah, that's a good idea. They always have a consensus. So I think he's playing into that manipulation of the masses in that way. Now, he's, you know, I'm not saying that he isn't a fascist. I'm not saying that he isn't a racist personally. I don't know him, never had dinner with him. But there are things that he has been involved in over the years, and living in New York City for years and years and years, it is very difficult to really... The person who Donald Trump is presenting himself to be, he has not always been that person. So I don't know.
Give me an example like what you're talking about.
Well, he's been involved with a lot of different kind of charitable programs. His hotels, you know, they do take in a lot of internship programs.
Yeah, man, of course.
And he has contributed financially to the Democratic Party. He's always been seen as a liberal and a Hillary, Gillibrand, you name the senator that needed to come to New York to pick up the delegates, and he has financed every single one of them.
But you know what? I hear him say that idea. Look, your man, me no politician say them a liar and them do things, because me as a businessman,
yeah, he paid them.
Him used to pay them.
Yeah.
So him know what him say.
Yeah, he knows what he's saying, and then, you know, of course, everyone has this mentality, well, if he's rich, then obviously he's going to do well for the country, but they don't know the history of Donald Trump, as he's the number one bankrupt magnate there is. There is no other billionaire that has had more bankruptcy issues than Donald Trump, from Trump Real Estate University, you name the program that he's been involved in. I don't know how him jump up and talking about the Middle East and he's going to do this, that, and the third. When I was in Dubai, I saw one of his buildings going up. So me know that he invests in the Middle East. I know that he has holdings all over the world. So he is the conversation that he's having is not the conversation of someone who's always only invested in America. This is a man who is very smart. He's a multinational.
Wait there. To be fair with him, you know, him admit that still, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Him admit, say,
most... But you don't think one of them, you don't think, well, look, if he was really about what he says he's about, one of those people are going to try to take some kind of vengeance on one of his properties that he has somewhere.
Yeah, but that's why 50 of them go meet off on the coast of Georgia to figure out how them going to stop him. You didn't hear about that?
Well, look.
50 of the richest billionaires in America.
Let me tell you, that place off the coast of Georgia, I didn't hear about it, but I'm going to tell you what that place represents. It's called Jekyll Island. The place off the coast of Georgia is a place that is traditionally where the billionaires meet to decide the master plan for the direction of the United States. That's where they came up with the Federal Reserve System, which is not an American banking system. That's where they came up with the IRS. That's where they came up with several different ways of how they're going to... how they're going to manipulate and guide the country without eyes prying them. Okay, so that's always been something that they've done. So I'm not surprised that they're trying to figure out how to stop him, because he's not in anyone's pocket. Big pharma is not behind him. The pharmaceutical companies, he didn't take a dollar from them. He is more dangerous And he's showing how dangerous he can be because he has no one pulling his strings. He can say just about anything. He can do anything. And he can handle anything because he feels like he's made of Teflon. All right? Now, if Donald Trump, let's say he goes as far as getting the nomination, let's say he goes as far as sitting in the presidency, what that means to countries like Jamaica and other countries who depend on trading with him, with the United States, he is a protectionist. He is looking at protecting, stopping trade, stopping this, stopping that, and trying to build up back the homeland. And let's blame the Mexicans, and let's blame the black people, and let's blame the women, and let's blame the Muslims, and the Syrians are going to come in, and they're going to create chaos in this country. And he has that rhetoric that he is protecting. That's what when someone says they're a conservative, they're conserving what they have. They are not trying to share. They're not trying to get any minimum wage increased for poor people. They're not trying to get any kind of education system. They're protecting, they're conserving the resources for the people who it belongs to. America was designed for as a white country, a white man's country. We the people, everybody knows we the people was meant for white people. It was supposed to be an all-white country, and that's why blacks, Mexicans, Indians, everybody else is considered the minority. There have to be the majority, and if you read the Constitution is a majority rule document, and this is why population control is essential. That's why they need abortion, homosexuality, and everything else that prevents a group from outstripping
like the Hispanics, like Latino them.
Yes.
I hear that they are more now.
They're the fastest growing population
in America right now.
In America, and they are trying to do everything that they can to at least grow that population faster than the black population. And if you look at every single piece of legislation, even the immigration documents, everything that you see come across the table from immigration, come down to healthcare, it is designed to help the Latin race to help them grow further, because they can't really tell the difference between a Spanish person and a white person, and it's better.
Yeah, like Rubio, whose parents are Cuban.
Right.
And Cruz, who parents is Cuban.
Right.
They can't tell them different.
No. And that's what they want. That's what they want. And so blacks will always be the minority. So when you walk into a room full of white people and there are only three black people, you are always going to be the minority. When you go to a place to work, you're the minority. That's why they can have this thing when they hire people. They can say, okay, we filled our quota for as many black people or as many Asian people as we want, because they have filled the quota for the minority. Affirmative action.
Yeah, we have to move, we have to move, sister.
Yes, all right,
call again and talk about your thing,
my thing you want to talk about
all right, go on, talk with
you. Yeah, man, okay, well, I want to big up the people that will invest in our Proudly. And anybody who wants to talk to me about it, proudlyapp@gmail.com, proudlyapp@gmail.com. And essentially, we're moving forward with a program. I'm moving into a space by JBDC on 76 Marcus Garvey Drive. Yeah, man, I'm setting up an office before I leave from Jamaica and return to China. I'm also doing sourcing.
You're going back to China?
Yes. Because basically the only way me can reach Africa at the moment is through China. China is the number one trading partner of almost every African country, as well as Jamaica. And through the shipping and getting things
done.
It's best for me to at least deal with the Chinese because they have, right. And I get my long stay and everything what I did need to be able to facilitate that.
Okay, beautiful.
I have a shipping partner that allows me to enter 10 Caribbean countries and 3 African countries, and I've got my own relationship with South Africa as well as Ethiopia.
Okay.
So my full steam ahead. Mm. It's me alone still same way. No, no financing, but me going through the same
he's
way.
Like Donald Trump, man.
Me go, me doing no quietly, financing. Man. Me kill them softly, man. Me kill all them right. softly.
Beautiful. I love your progress, you know. I love your progress, man.
Yeah, man. Me really appreciate it. And so what I want to say is anybody who sees me or hear me say that I am also going to assist persons to purchase from China, yes, because that is a low-hanging fruit. It is available to me. People want goods from China, but at the same time, I'm also helping Jamaican manufacturers to enter into the Chinese market. It is very tricky. You can't just jump up and say, "I'm gonna send something go to China." You need proper descriptions. You need an importing agent and then a distributor. So I'm focusing on bilateral trade and entering the African market as well.
All right. Get so, down.
We'll call it when we get the date for my launch at Jampro.
All right, but, Mama. Definitely. All right. Definitely.
All right. Good, Musa. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, man. That is Renee, the sister who we first had on the program talking about her computer wizardness. She is now venturing into markets beyond the shores of Jamaica, all by her little self. Remember, I said she was looking some finance to go to Jordan, and she actually did go to Jordan, and she ended up now in China, and she is making some headways into that market. So we feel proud of her. We feel proud of her, considering that she is alone. She's very alone. I never say she's lonely, and I say she's alone. You understand? I never say she's lonely. Don't mix up the alone with lonely. She's not lonely. She's alone in her ventures. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM. I want to heal up me hungry, as usual. Yes. Why heal up me hungry? Me see if you're down there. I go on. Nice. Me hungry down on Main Street. So who provide me with food in the night and food in the day too. You understand? We want to heal up Brian and we want to heal up Tracy. Brian and Tracy. Supposed to there with me. All right. I don't know who is the operator outside there. Should I heal up the operator? But I don't know who is the operator outside there. Lynn Tate and the Jets. Fam.
Like a bazooka, you are listening to Muta Baruka.
Music and some freedom, love. Sounds to really make you. chip on the left hand side. Pass the Dutch chip on the left hand side.
You are listening to Muta Baruka.
It a go down. Jano. It is a cool and lonely breezy afternoon.
How does it feel when you got no food?
I could feel it cause it was the month of
June. How does it feel when you got no food?
So I left my gate and went out for a walk.
How does it feel when you got no food?
As I passed the dreadlocks camp I heard them say,
how does it feel when you got no food?
Pass the Dutchie on the left hand side. Pass the Dutchie on the left hand side. It a go bun.
Give me the music, make me jump and pump.
It a go bun.
Give me the music, make me looking at it all.
The man with the man. I remind you that we'll be back here later from 2 to 5:45 with the Stepping Razor, the art of war.
What was going on?
How does it feel when you got no food?
Cause the spirit of Jah, you know he leads you on.
How does it feel when you got no food?
There was a ring of jets and the session was there in swing.
How does it feel when you got no food?
I could feel the chill as I seen and heard them say.
How does it feel when you got no food?
Pass the Dutchie on the left hand side. Pass the Dutchie on the left hand side. It's a go bun.
Give me the music, make me jump and pump.
It's a go bun.
Give me the music, make me jump.
Chip on the left hand side. Pass the Dutch chip on the left hand side. It a go bun.
Give me the music, make me jump and pump.
It a go bun.
Give me the music, make me looking at it all. You play it on the radio, and so me say we a go hear it on the stereo. And so me know we a go play it on the disco. And so me say we a go hear it on the stereo. Stereo.
Pass the Dutch chip on the left hand side.
Dig it.
the law.